Welcome to Washington, D.C. Yes, sir, the gang is all here officially as we're ready to crank this thing up the next couple days. It's going to be outstanding. We've already seen some great basketball. All right, working out as we speak.
Syracuse on one end,
NC State here. That's our first game up tonight when we finish up at 7 p.m. Let's talk about the nightcap. Guards on guards. Again, DJ Horn's going to be the million-dollar question as far as I'm concerned.
Oh, yeah.
Joel, listen, you played the position. DJ Horn, when he's right, NC State's a different beast. They found a way to win last night, but that guard play from Syracuse is no joke.
Yeah, I disagree with Steve Forbes a little bit. I think offense wins championships.
Shocker.
I think offense wins. And so having a guy like DJ Horn, you need him on the court. But I thought NC State did a really good job yesterday. Not only did they not have DJ Horn, they didn't play much with DJ Burns.
Yeah, and 11 minutes or so.
11 minutes. So they were able to get the job done. But hopefully DJ Horn will be ready, because we see the guy right there on the screen. And Judah Mintz and J.J. Starling, those guys can get after it, and they will need to be able to combat that firepower with their own offense. So I just really think that Syracuse is a hard team to guard, and really you have to slow them down as much as you can. But they need a guy like DJ Horn to be in the game tonight, and hopefully he does show up and play.
But I think what I noticed and what stood out to me last night about NC State was, of course, they didn't have DJ Horn, but it was Casey Morcell who really stepped up big. Jaden Taylor's had a really good couple of games, but he feels like the X factor for NC State. I know Michael McConnell doesn't necessarily score a ton. He had 16 last night.
Yeah, played great.
So the contribution as a team without their best player is what stood out to me, Luke.
And that's how you got to do it. If your guy is not going to be in the game, it's not like somebody's just going to all of a sudden start scoring 35. You got to pass those points out. You got to play together. I think most importantly, you got to use your defense as a team to slow down a guy like Judah Mintz, because he sees one defender in front of him. That's not enough. You got to build a wall with multiple defenders, close in on those gaps, and really force Syracuse to shoot jump shots, really everybody but Chris Bell. And then when you run Chris Bell off the line, he's another guy that can get in the paint. He's got that length. Judah Mintz is a guy who can get wherever he wants on the floor. Same thing with J.J. Starling. You got to get these guys out of rhythm early.
Does it worry you at all? Because we just talked about it with Steve Forbes. He said he liked that he played a game today before heading into the Pitt one. You have to remember, Syracuse hasn't played since last Tuesday.
Yeah,
they didn't play over the weekend. We just saw the women had the same scenario in the ACC Women's Tournament and got ousted really early. As a player, former player, Joel, start with you. Does that concern you at all for Syracuse?
You know, it is a concerning factor, but that's why when we tried to get here and get established, we tried to practice like we were trying to prepare for a game that day, because you want to be able to get your legs going and get acclimated. I always thought that you had to look at the teams that, you know, got some games in already, and you have to be prepared because they're warm. You're in this gym. They're already acclimated to the soft rims, as we saw in the first day. So it is a worrying factor, but you competed for a championship. I feel like that's just an excuse.
Right.
You're competing for a championship. You have to show up and play the game.
I just think it's a little bit of a thin roster. You know, they don't have a ton of depth.
Right.
If it's a Florida State, I like them getting shots up, getting that win under their belt. If it's Syracuse, I like them getting a little bit more rest. I like those guys being really fresh coming into this game. Judah Mintz plays a ton of minutes, and he's going to have to in this game, and he's going to have to be really good. Louisville gave NC State everything they wanted, right? They had to press at the end of that game, and now that you have a shorter rotation, especially in that backcourt for NC State, you're going to have the legs to compete today.
You know, certain teams match up with certain teams for whatever reason.
Yep.
You name the sport. Syracuse seems to have NC State's number. Now, it doesn't matter if they're playing Raleigh up the dome, whatever. I know tonight's a whole different ball game. But I think, sometimes teams just go, hey, you know what? We got these guys. And you two have played at the highest level. There's just certain times you know you're going to win the game.
That's the announcer's jinx if I've ever heard it. go ahead,
I'm not an announcer.
Knock on wood.
And I believe that, you know what, if I'm 2-0 against you, I'm going to be 3-0 against you. I believe in that.
Yeah, I mean, I like that mindset. You put that confidence into your team, come out and take care of business. But what you're saying about getting a dress rehearsal, getting a game under your belt, you just have to make sure those first few minutes that the intensity is there. We were a team that pressed, so you kind of had to force that tempo on the game. You had to put your will on the game early. Syracuse is not pressing. You know, like I said, they're a thin roster, so you're going to see them drop back. Are they intense enough? Are they executing at a high level, crisp enough early on in this game to take control early? Because I think if you do that, you take away NC State from the three-point line, Syracuse will get the job done.
ACC PM from Washington, D.C. Good evening to everyone on the East Coast because it's 6:01 p.m. West Durham got the memo, no ties.
Yep.
Taylor Tannenbaum, bad hands on the ball toss.
The first one was low. The second one was lower, and I caught the rest.
860-766-4258 is the hotline number.
Listen, I always say if you dish it, you got to be able to take it. The smack talk. So it's fine. If you thought I did bad, call in.
So the most outstanding player in this league could not toss it correctly.
I think there were some issues on both ends, yes. Okay. It's a team effort, you know?
If he wants to impress Packer tonight, Red Panda will have to make a play.
Yes. Oh. 3 feet to the right. See if she can go to
let's
her
see,
right.
Let's see if Red Panda can move. Let's see if we can make a play.
I get to sit next to two of my favorite guys here.
Yeah, bless your heart.
The ACC tournament.
All right, Mr. Durham, back in Washington, D.C. for the first time in a while.
Yep.
It's not Greensboro, it's not Charlotte, but it is D.C.
It's got
its own vibe. It's always had its storylines. This is the third go-around. I know it's still early in the process, this game tonight. I think it's going to be really good. In fact, both games, I think, have a chance to be really entertaining. And then tomorrow, it's go time. But initial thoughts, you've been here all week.
I think, first of all, 8 years is the right amount of time from 2000. I was not here at the event in 2016. I was here the first time we were in this building in 05. The area around the arena is terrific.
Awesome.
People here in Washington, I think, have certainly embraced the event. I think the part that I find most interesting, Pac, is that the six times the ACC's brought the event, either the three to the Capitol Center or now the three in this building, that we see a more of a collection of alums and fans, really. I mean, Charlotte and Greensboro got their own personalities for the event. This one is unique. It's different than Brooklyn, right?
Yeah,
I mean, it feels very different than Brooklyn, and completely different than when we went to Tampa or the times we've been to Atlanta. So I would say thumbs up to Washington. I'm okay with it coming around, no question about it, in this market.
And be honest with you, the folks here in Washington should be excited that the ACC is here as well.
Yep.
Because the Washington Wizards are 11-54. They've got the worst record in the NBA.
Yeah.
And they're 4-26 in this building. And there is a chance that an ACC team could win four games this week to match the Wizards for all season.
Yeah, they've already seen more collaborative wins in the building than they've seen all year.
Yeah, this week they're guaranteed wins in this building.
Yeah.
That's the best part, regardless of who does it.
Yeah. That's just something I just said. That's what I just observed from afar. Since I just got
Thank goodness
town.
Ovechkin skates here, right? Yeah. I mean, so it works out well, I
That's
guess.
That's it.
Yeah.
You got it.
You were on a couple of calls yesterday, the two late-night games. So you already got to see NC State Louisville play, and we're getting ready. You see the red behind us now. Heading into today's game against Syracuse, what's at the top of the scouting reporter if you were going to be watching this one?
DJ Horn's playing.
Yeah.
That's number one.
There you go.
And Horn in the lineup tonight is a win for Kevin Keats. Now, question becomes this. NC State scored a season-high 94 last night with DJ Horn wearing a really nice necklace on the bench last night. Can that temperament carry over to tonight with him back in the lineup? Does he hunt shots more? Casey Morsell, a career high last night. NC State, I thought, maybe didn't guard the way they want to guard, but they created the tempo exchange that certainly was productive for them. I think DJ Horn tonight will be interesting. He and Casey Morsell. Casey Morsell's childhood buddy is Judah Mintz.
Right.
So how does that go tonight? Syracuse has beaten NC State twice convincingly. That's got to be a bit of a concern tonight for Kevin Keats. Can they get early momentum? They didn't have any momentum in the game in January at the Dome. And then in Raleigh, Chris Bell went crazy in the first half.
Eight threes in the first half.
Yeah, so if Chris Bell goes crazy tonight or Syracuse gets off to another good start, how's NC State handle that tonight?
It's unbelievable that we are all able to get together. We're all like brothers to each other. We grew up together, so to speak. I'm just proud to be a part of that team.
They have done it. The Wolfpack has won the national championship.
We were 57-1 over a two-year period, won the first national championship at North Carolina State, and will go down in history as one of the greatest college basketball teams ever.
We'd gone undefeated in the ACC, and still we had to win the Maryland game just to get out of ACC tournament play and into the NCAA tournament.
There was a lot of pressure on that game. You know, only one team could represent the conference, and Maryland was probably playing the best basketball of the season.
They were ranked number one in the country. We were ranked number four by most polls, and here we are recognizing that one of the four best teams in the nation was not going to go to the NCAA tournament.
That game changed the whole outlook of the NCAA. ACC was the only team that sent their tournament winner. Everybody else sent their conference winner. Only 25 teams were in the NCAA tournament.
Both teams have played phenomenal basketball and are hungry for this biggest of all triumphs.
In that championship game, they opted not to double and leave Tommy one-on-one against Elmore.
I had nobody but Elmore to guard me, so it was either, you know, back step, drop. I have a 5.5-foot drop step. That will move you. He couldn't stop me. I mean, he's right there on my hook shot. I mean, he's not going to get up and get it.
As many good games as I saw David Thompson play, I don't know that I ever saw a better individual performance than that 38-point game from Tommy Burleson that night.
The greatest thing you can say about this team is we gave ourselves the opportunity, and when we got the opportunity, we delivered.
It's all over. The most exciting basketball contest ever played in the ACC.
You have a bunch of 18, 19, 20-year-old kids together. All those guys would be linked for life. We cannot be around each other for years and come back together. It's just like back in 1974. I love those guys.
Special team right there, ladies and gentlemen. Nothing quite like it. Jaden Taylor from NC State doing his thing.
That's DJ Burns.
Yeah, that's Burns. He's ready to roll. The other DJ's got to be ready to roll tonight.
He's playing.
That's the key.
Hey, he looks good. I saw him about 15 minutes ago doing some stretching, some soft running, and had his headphones on and his game shoes, which was a little different than last night.
Uh-huh.
So there you go.
The sneaks make all the difference in the world, Pat.
Tell me about it. David Thiel joined us. We just
sitting here
watching that incredible 1974, hard to believe, 50-year anniversary of the greatest ACC basketball game. And you could make the case the greatest college basketball game you'd ever want to see, given what was at stake and the talent that was on the floor. You've been covering this thing for just a few days.
A few. Here and there.
Yeah, not every now and then.
41 years. I saw you tweet
41 consecutive, yes.
It's amazing.
All right, how about let's go down memory lane a little bit.
Sure.
I mean, that game, obviously,
put that one on the side. I was a kid at home watching that game. And
we all were, but thanks.
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, that era is what I think made us all fall in love with ACC basketball.
Yeah.
And then 10 years following that, 1984 is the first one I got to attend and cover. And it was the only one that Lefty Driesell, God bless him, ever did win. And he came into that press room at the Greensboro Coliseum and said, I'm going to bolt this trophy to the hood of my Cadillac and drive around the Tar Heel State.
I remember when he grabbed the mic at midcourt in the ceremony, and that's when he laid that line on everybody. I was in there sitting there watching it.
Yeah.
And even if you didn't like Maryland, you sat there and you said, you know what, this is awesome.
Well, and think about this, too. The 84 game is the foundation to what Duke ultimately did, because Mike Krzyzewski talks about they beat Carolina in the semifinals.
Yes.
And then they lost to Maryland, but because they beat Carolina, they had the momentum off that regular season loss they took in Chapel Hill.
Yep.
They got revenge against Carolina, and look what happened a couple of years later. Duke wins the title in 86 for the first time with Kay, goes to the Final Four in Dallas.
Yes.
And so the parallels in the league have never gone away, right? One foundation kind of leads to another.
Yeah.
And for me, I think the first time they were ever in D.C. is a big deal. I think the Capitol Center and Virginia winning in 76 outside the state of North Carolina for the first time with the event. Bob James, the late commissioner, wanted the event. I mean, he was a Maryland grad. That didn't have anything to do with it, but he wanted to take it outside the state. D.C. was a willing participant to host it back. Wally Walker takes Virginia the title. I still think to this day that's one of the most important tournament titles ever.
And they did it as a sixth seed and to win their first one.
Yep.
And who knows, maybe history is made this week when the sixth seed wins their first championship.
Clemson, that Pack.
Possible.
I've been on the Clemson bandwagon all season. I really have. I think they've got a really good club. They're solidly in the NCAA field. And that if the Tigers can get by Quentin Post and BC tonight, that is a very tricky quarterfinal for the third-seeded Cavaliers late tomorrow night.
Well, they have to exercise some demons against Virginia because Virginia's had their number.
They have.
Yeah.
And the game at Little John, the only time they met this regular season, came down to a wide slam-open Jack Clark three at the top of the key. He missed it, and the Cavaliers win by one.
And Coach went home with a timeout, and he stands by it.
Yeah.
I remember it. When we're talking about memories, I'm just taking the walk down memory lane with them. your favorite to cover, is there a game that stands out to you that when you were covering it, you walked into that press room and sat down to write, and you were like, man, and the words just came spilling out?
One game? Wow. Well, Randolph Childress. In 95, what was it, 107 points? Do I have that right in 3 days? What?
According to Carolina fans, it was 1,000.
it may well have been. If to have watched that over a three-day period where he literally carried his team to a championship, that was to me just so defining and so impressive.
I think of recent note, Taylor, 19 in Charlotte, where three number ones came out of the field. Mm-hmm. We had the Zion Tour de Force. Williamson was phenomenal. Game one, the semis against Carolina, championship game against Florida State Pack. I mean, you and I sat there and just were like, holy cow, this is unbelievable how good this guy is. And he set the building on fire for three nights. Like right from the start, he took the ball on like the third possession against Syracuse in the quarterfinal, Taylor, smashed a dunk going down the floor, and it was just on from there. And I still think 5 years ago when Williamson took over the building in Charlotte for three nights, Pack, that was about as good as it's been a long time.
All right, I'm going to give you two completely offbeat ones.
Okay.
The first ACC tournament game I ever attended was when John Roach had hurt his ankle. South Carolina was the number one team, and NC State beat him in the Chrome Dome in Charlotte. It was like 42-39 kind of thing.
Oh, that was the Bobby Crimmins game.
Bobby Crimmins. Couldn't recover from it.
That's it.
No, he never did.
Yeah.
Until Georgia Tech won it.
Well, in 85, not like Virginia in 76. Georgia Tech in 85 at the Omni in Atlanta, after the tournament had been there once in 83 when NC State won and magically started their run, felt like that Georgia Tech, like Virginia 9 years earlier, felt like in 85 Georgia Tech kind of lifted themselves up as a program and member in this league.
The other one I'm going to give you had nothing to do with a championship. But being in the building, I'm not sure I've ever felt an ACC tournament building moment like the night that Rick Barnes went after Dean Smith.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
Because every fan base, I'll never forget it, every fan base picked a side instantly.
93, right?
And I might have been later than that.
Okay.
But instantly, even if you weren't really paying attention to the game, you were into the game. I mean, from the corner of the upper deck, people were enthralled, and they could not wait to see somebody throw a punch. And, of course, Commissioner Corrigan called them both into the principal's office the next day.
But on the slide, probably thank them because he knew how that was going to play.
That was one of the all-time nights.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no question.
You know I love a little spice, so I'm here for that.
Well, that had spice.
You know I love a little spice.
Well, and it was building, right, in the regular season. I was not covering the league in 93. I was in the SEC at Vanderbilt.
They still in the league over there?
Yeah, kind of. They. I don't know. We got to check the scores.
They got sweatshirts now that says, at least we're not Missouri.
That's right, yeah. But here's the thing. Taylor, the thing about Barnes and Coach Smith, it was building. It started layering a little bit during the regular season, right? And Ikara Turbe, Pack. That was our guy,
Turbe,
right?
Turbe. Keep your hands off my player.
Yeah. It's amazing how this tournament does that, right? And, you know, in the last few years, we've been kind of very blasé about things. We've had the tournament. It's been fine. We haven't had a lot of hot sauce.
It was electric.
Yeah, it was.
I mean, it was. People buzzed about it the next day, like, oh, my goodness, could you believe what happened?
Yeah.
Guys, if we get Duke Carolina 3 on Saturday night, we might have some hot sauce again.
Well, first of all, Duke's got to take the lead. They've only had the lead for 16 seconds in the first
80
two games.
Minutes. It's remarkable.
Yeah. You got to have a little bit more than that for the juice. But, you know, that's what makes this tournament, though, unlike any other one. Yeah. There's so much tradition in history.
Yeah, absolutely.
Even with the expansion of the schedule and the bracket to the 15 teams, it's been interesting to watch, like, last night in here when Boston College started rolling in the second half. Claudel Harris hits the long three. Madsen hit a three. You know, BC, who, quite frankly, has not had a lot to rally with here in the last few years, even with Earl Grant's success, felt like Boston College built some momentum. I think that's why it'll be interesting to watch Syracuse in here tonight.
They
really wanted to be successful in this event, David, and have not been able to do it yet.
Right, and you talk about a team that hasn't been successful, or a program that hasn't been successful in the event, Clemson. Guys, only twice in its history has Clemson advanced two rounds in the ACC tournament. The most recent was 2008 under Oliver Purnell, and the first was in 62 when Press Maravich was the head coach, Pistol's daddy.
And that's the night Billy Packer screwed Clemson to win the ACC title. Wake beat Clemson.
Wow.
I'm giving you some inside info.
Wow.
If Billy were here today, he didn't admit he did it. That's why I went to school at Clemson, because it just nauseating what Billy did to my Tigers. Now you know the rest of the
story. The rest of the story.
I'm going to put the trophy on my car and drive all over North Carolina.
Back to ACC PM. We're 25 minutes away from NC State and Syracuse.
And State fans like this sight. That's DJ Horn out there on the floor just a couple minutes ago warming up. You see Wes Durham talked about his game shoes. He looks like he's ready to go. I know they got the dub last night, but always better when you have your guard DJ Horn out there.
All right. We are joined by the legendary Jim Boeheim and Carlos Boozer.
Legendary Carlos Boozer.
No.
You're legendary.
I said the legendary Jim Boeheim and Carlos Boozer. Coach, let me tell you, us old guys on the end, I got your back on this. For 30 minutes, I got your back.
I need all the help I can get.
Yeah. All right, let's talk about this game coming up here at the top of the hour. Carlos, DJ Horn comes back. We'll find out if he's at 100% or where he is. But he is a difference maker when he's really good. And these Syracuse guards are outstanding.
Absolutely. I mean, we were talking about the Syracuse guards yesterday. I think Judah Mintz is one of the best we have in the country. But DJ Horn has been special for this team, just like DJ Burns has been special for them as well. Going inside, Casey Marcel was terrific yesterday. I think it was 13 for 13 from the free throw line, which is outstanding. But they had 94 points without him yesterday.
Right.
That's pretty impressive. But it'll be different today. They're going to get a lot more pressure. I feel like Judah Mintz, his penetration is becoming a hell of a playmaker for his teammates. Obviously, he can score the basketball, which is one of his great gifts. But being able to pass the ball this year, Coach, and get his teammates involved, takes Syracuse to a whole other level.
Yeah, when they shoot it well, they can beat anybody.
Yeah.
Well, they beat NC State, but Chris Bell made 8 straight threes to start the game, and they win by 4. So this is a very difficult game. Syracuse played great when we played NC State. And I just thought NC State yesterday really played great. I mean,
they did.
Really did. And sometimes you can do that when you don't have your best player. Other guys pick it up. And my question always is, when you see a guy come back, I've seen it both ways. A guy will play great and a guy will struggle. And you never know when the guy comes back after missing.
First of all, Coach, I want to know, it is so loud. Do you feel at home with the Syracuse band behind you? Is that why you're not flinching at all?
This is the worst. I went from the best seat in the building to the worst seat because we're right next to the band.
That we brought them just for you.
And it's like 4 hours.
And I know, if we're talking the guard play and just how Syracuse is going to be a different dynamic against NC State today, and they've had their number. Coach, you're really high on the pick and roll, especially lately from the orange.
Well, Malik Brown is a difference maker because he can roll and finish or pass, so he can do both things. He's really the key in this game, handling Burns down low. It'll be Malik Brown will be a big key.
It would seem to me that for a guy that's got his name on the court, you could snap your fingers and have the band be quiet, just like that.
I had little power. I had no power. But that's the play. When Judah makes these plays, they get wide open shots, and he can finish if you don't guard and stop him. He can finish. Against Carolina, he was out of this world, just making shots and making plays. It's one of the best games I've seen a guard play. I think he really deserved to be a first-team All-League player. He is sixth in the league in scoring, third in steals, and third in assists. I don't think he can do much better than that as a guard. I think he'll try to prove something today.
You know, we had Coach Forbes stop by after Wake's big win this afternoon, and we asked him about, hey, they're going to play Pitt tomorrow. He's got a game under his belt. Pitt hasn't played yet. He gave a coach's perspective, and Jim, I know you've been there. Carlos, I'm going to ask you, you know what? Here's Syracuse. Life is good. They've not played in a while, right?
Last Tuesday.
So here's NC State. Played last night. Wasn't necessarily pretty, but it was a W. They got a taste of what it's like, and now DJ Horn's in the lineup. From a player's perspective, how big a deal is that you've either played or haven't played a game yet?
I think two things. One, when you have time off, you get a chance to sharpen up a little bit. For the coaching staff, you get a chance to really prepare your team for what lies ahead. They got a chance to watch an entire game yesterday while their feet was kicked up on the couch. Syracuse is going to have a lot of energy, okay, because they've been waiting for this moment, this game, for this season. NC State has some momentum. They won a game last night against Louisville. They played really well without their best offensive weapon. He's coming back today. To Coach's point, it's very interesting to see how that dynamic goes, because everybody galvanizes when you're missing a guy, because you can't replace one guy with one guy, so the whole team does it. Now he comes back. Is he gonna be over-aggressive? Is he going to be looking to play make? I'm curious to see on how he handles coming back into the fold after his team. They put up 94 points without him yesterday. That's really impressive.
I think the statistics in history that I've seen, the team that has got a game under its belt wins that game a lot. That happens a lot. Even when they're a much higher, worse seed, that game under your belt helps. Syracuse has to overcome that. They have to be able to overcome that tonight.
I was talking about it earlier with the guys when we had Joel and Luke on. From a coach's perspective, you can weigh in on this too. The three times in a season facing a team thing. I think I know your take on it, but is there something to that, the third go-around for either team? Advantage one side or no?
I think if you beat a team easily in a couple games, then you're going to win. The two games were down to the wire.
Right.
And so when you have those two, then I think anything can happen in the third game.
Wait a minute now. Jim, you play a lot of golf. I used to play a lot of golf. You know what? If you and I are going to go play match play, and you've worn me out twice, and they say, guess what? Next week in the club championship, Boeheim versus Packer, you'd sit there and go, I'm going to wear him out again.
Absolutely, but that's individual.
More elements.
I'd like to see this, the match ACC Network edition. That would be fun.
Coach is a sandbagger. That's the problem. He's over there. He'll throw a 9 on the scorecard. Just get that handicap up for the member.
How'd you shoot yesterday?
102 on Congressional on Monday. Not bad.
That's not bad.
Monday.
In the window.
That's not bad.
It was windy.
Okay. Take your word for it.
But all right, from a player's perspective, you know what? Hey, we beat these guys twice. Yeah. You know what? We're not going to roll the ball out. We got to get to work. But I like my chances, right, mentally?
You have a mental edge over the other team. Yeah. Like, even if it's close for a little bit. But I will say, it's very hard to beat a team three times because you get so – that's why the NBA playoffs are so interesting, because you got to beat a team four times to advance. Very hard to do. And the same thing goes for college. You see, like, I remember us when we were in 2001, won the championship. We saw Maryland four times that year.
Yeah.
We got it done when it counted the most, obviously, in the Final Four to advance to the championship. But we were down 22 in that game. We had to claw our way back into that game. So it is very difficult to do. But that being said, there is a mental edge when you've dominated a team. These games were very close, so it's a very different situation. It could go either way.
For people who don't remember this game, this matchup earlier in the season, Clemson won it, but Boston College was without several players. Quinn Post did not play in that game, and they still held their own in that one, so it'll be a different situation. You're our resident big guy. I know a lot of us will be watching that battle in the front court. PJ Hall, Ian Shefflin, Quinn Post. What do you like about that dynamic against each other?
I can't wait for this big man matchup. They're both so versatile. They both can spread the floor and shoot the three. They both got great footwork on the block. They can finish with both hands. They both make their free throws. And they're both the center point for their offense, on offense and defense for their team. I think it's going to be a heavyweight fight down there on the block and on the perimeter with these two guys. And to your point, Quinn Post didn't play in that game. Did you see him yesterday? He was outstanding yesterday, so I'm looking forward to it.
And it was a close game in Clemson, even though they played with both hands tied behind their back. And that was on the road. Anything can happen tonight.
Well, not only that, but a couple other guys were sick in that game, too. Yep. So I think it's like I love Clemson's team, but this will be a test. And it's not out of the question Boston College will win this game tonight. They could win this game tonight. I don't think that takes anything away from what I think Clemson is going to do in the NCAA tournament. I still think they're going to be a factor in that tournament. And I remember the year we lost to Connecticut in 2003, and something pretty good happened after that. you can lose in this tournament, and you can have a great NCAA tournament. And I think Clemson's going to do that.
Yeah. And I know for you, you've obviously coached in this tournament a ton. And in that locker room now, getting ready to come out, is Adrian Autry, your longtime assistant. And you obviously known him for a long time as a player there at Syracuse, too. Do you offer up a word of advice for his first ACC tournament at all?
No, he's done an unbelievable job this year. Yeah. We talk a lot, but he's done a great coaching job. He's got six sophomores. I mean, I voted for him for Coach of the Year. I think he lost his two big guys. He lost his power forward. And he navigated through this season with six sophomores. And five of them didn't play much last year. So you're talking about Judah Mintz, the only sophomore that really played a lot. So to get to 20 wins is pretty spectacular coaching. And the one thing I'm glad I'm sitting here.
Yeah, right.
And not sitting out there, because the worst time in coaching is the 20 minutes before the game.
Yeah.
That's the worst time.
The worst time.
The worst. There's no other time worse than that 20 minutes.
What did you do in that 20-minute span?
I started to actually either look at tapes or read a book, something, just to get your mind off the game.
Yeah.
Because you just got to get to that game. Once the game starts, everything's fine.
Right.
But that 20 minutes, 30 minutes before, it's a long time.
What about you? Player mindset 20 minutes before a game.
I was locked in. I mean, I was so, by the 20-minute mark, I was so locked in on my opponent. I'm watching what he does. I'm watching individual film of what my opponent does, because usually you want to win your, if you win,
right
your,
before a
if
game.
If everybody wins your matchup, you usually win the game, right?
Yeah.
So I'm locking on whoever I'm going against, if it was Lonnie Baxter or Brendan Haywood or whoever the matchup for me was at that time. I'm watching what their tendencies are, what their strengths are, their weaknesses are, how they run plays to get them the ball, what he does defensively so I can figure out where to be offensively for my guys. And by the time the game tips, it's like, bring it on. We've been preparing for this game for so long. These guys out here have been waiting for this moment the whole season to prove that they can advance in the ACC tournament. So it's going to be a fun night.
All right, you guys going to hang tight. We got to give out our predictions.
I already gave one away.
Well, we know where that one's coming from. I know where this guy's leaning. We'll take a quick break here. But when we come back, big time picks before we get to ready for what should be another great night of ACC basketball and the tournament here from beautiful Washington, D.C.
We need some baby headphones.
We're going to start with the nightcap, though. Clemson, Boston College. Booze, let it rip. What you got?
I got Clemson. And for me, I know they got a lot of things around them. It's because of P.J. Hall for me. I think he's so versatile inside and outside. He's had like an All-American type of year. So I got Clemson.
I got Clemson in a close game.
Okay.
Taylor.
Me? I got Clemson, too, three times. What does that mean for you, Mr. Packers? A sweeper?
Given the fact that I'm a graduate from 1985, if I picked against them, Coach, they would absolutely say, you got to get out of here. Clemson wins tonight.
That means
they're
going to
make some
College.
Noise, too. I'm buying all that. All right, the game that's coming up here in moments. Big one. Syracuse, NC State, Boots.
I got Syracuse. I think Judah Mintz is going to be the best player on the floor. He's so dynamic. He can score. He can set his teammates up. And when he does that, they're unbelievable.
There's only one team I'm picking. I want to go home. I want to get back into town.
I love it.
All right, that was an easy pick. I am going to actually go NC State. I said it earlier this week that NC State will win two games in this tournament. So I'm doubling down. I'm saying third time's the charm. They're going to beat Syracuse this time. I'm just saying.
I don't think State's going to win two games. I like All Syracuse right. tonight because if I picked against them, Boeheim's coming right over the table to get me. Yeah. I know that much.
And somebody's not going to dinner with us.
Dinner's canceled, unfortunately.
We got to get out of here. Folks, enjoy the hoops. Enjoy the softball. We are back tomorrow in between sessions and all that good stuff. Should be an awesome night and day of basketball here in the ACC in Washington, D.C. For all the smart people, they're back in Bristol. Catch you later. Enjoy the night.
Washington, D.C., a beautiful night in the Capitol. It's almost an even split between Syracuse, New York, and Raleigh, North Carolina. And smack in the middle, that's where the action is tonight. You're watching ESPN's Champ Week, presented by Principal. This is the ACC Men's Basketball Tournament, presented by T. Rowe Price. Tonight, the number 7 seed and the 10 seed, the Orange and the Wolfpack, squaring off here in round 2. Now, earlier today, plenty of action here in D.C. Florida State got a tremendous effort from Jameer Watkins. 34 points to beat Virginia Tech. The Seminoles flying into the quarterfinal round. That will be tomorrow. And the game that followed, Wake Forest got a must win over Notre Dame. A very balanced attack. It was certainly a must win if the Demon Deacons want to be included in the big dance. So we check out the bracket. FSU facing the number 1 seed, North Carolina, at noon tomorrow. Wake Forest and Pitt will meet at 2:30 in the 4-5 game. Duke and Virginia awaiting their opponents. And tonight, number 11 seeded Boston College taking on the 6 seed Clemson. Thanks so much for being with us here in Washington, everybody. Dave O'Brien, my partner Corey Alexander, Angel Gray joining us in just a couple of moments. And Corey, this will be the third meeting between these two teams. The first couple of games, well, we know how that went. Syracuse won them both.
Yeah, it went Syracuse's way, but they say that it's hard to beat a good team 3 times. So what we're going to find out tonight, is North Carolina State a good team? They absolutely looked like it yesterday, scoring a season-high 94 points, and more importantly, getting to the free throw line 40 times, OB. They lived there, making 33 of those 40 attempts.
Well, take a look at that season series and how it has gone down between these two. And can't say absolute dominance for Syracuse, but they won it on January 27, 77-65. Syracuse beating NC State 87-83, a tighter game in February. Starling averaging almost 20 points a game against the Wolfpack.
And there are a number of guys who have had some spectacular numbers from the Orange against the Wolfpack, including Malik Brown, first-team all-defensive ACC, and Quadia Copeland. Both those guys had elite performances against the Wolfpack.
Time to bring in Angel Gray. And what is the big news tonight for NC State? The question is DJ Horn going to play? He didn't yesterday because of a hip problem. What's the verdict on that, Angel?
You're right, OB. He was listed as questionable for tonight's game. He went through a 15-minute warm-up earlier. He said he felt great. He gave his trainer the thumbs up, so he is cleared to go. So what does that mean for the Wolfpack in game 2? Well, Coach Keith said the thing that he loved about their previous game was that they were able to share the ball. All but one player had an assist. 5 of them had 2 or more. So what he was saying about the insertion of DJ Horn, making sure the ball doesn't stick, no hero ball, and making sure unselfish play is what helps him advance in this tournament.
Well, he's such a big factor when he's on the floor. 31 points against Wake Forest, 32 against Syracuse, had at least 25, 5 consecutive games earlier this season. He can absolutely explode.
He absolutely can. And now one of the things where Angel talked about the ball not sticking, the way they shared the basketball yesterday, if DJ Horn comes in and plays that way, this North Carolina State team can be dangerous.
NC State at 18-14, Syracuse 20-11, and still has hopes of an NCAA bid. And when their backcourt is good for the Orange, it is off the charts good. Judah Mintz right in the thick of that. His first pass can't be finished up, but it will be eventually on the dunk by Brown.
This is the interesting part right here for me. When you're thinking about the size advantage that NC State has with DJ Burns in the post, you see Kevin Keats wants to go to him immediately.
Marcel will fire. His first shot won't drop. Syracuse comes away with the rebound. Marcel, 25 points against Louisville yesterday. Give you a look at the Syracuse starting lineup: Starling, Mintz, Taylor, Bell, and Brown. Bell, one of those orange shooters who just went off against the Wolfpack in one of those two victories. His first half in one of the games, he had 26.
Yeah, it was 8 for 10 from beyond the three-point arc in that game. He's actually had two games this season, OB, where he's been 8 for 10 as the shot clock gets down under 3 seconds.
Mintz has to heave it and can't connect. And Diarra snatching a rebound as we look at the Wolfpack starting lineup. They had dropped 4 in a row before their win yesterday. O'Connell, Taylor, Marcel, Burns, and Diarra.
Diarra missing on the three there. Kevin Keats has told us he is a better player when he makes a three. He has a different level of energy when he's made a three in the ballgame. Great offensive rebounder and defensive rebounder as well, but an elite defender.
Winner will take on the number 2 seed Duke at 7 tomorrow. Mintz with a pull-up pop, and he'll drain that. Judah Mintz named to the second team All-ACC.
And Michael O'Connell was great defensively for the Wolfpack yesterday, but he's going up against a different challenge here this evening, having to defend that second teamer in Judah Mintz, who averages close to 19 points a game.
And we'll see when DJ Horn will enter the fray. DJ Burns with it. So much is likely to get through him, especially if the Wolfpack are going to pull out a win tonight.
But when you watch how they defend DJ Burns when he has the basketball, you see Malik Brown on the top side, Justin Taylor just waiting in the middle of the paint for him to spin back towards the baseline.
Shot clock at 8, and going to be a whistle here and a foul.
They're going to get Chris Bell on that one.
That'll be number 1 on Bell.
Yeah, fouling Jaden Taylor, shooting the 3. And we watched Taylor yesterday, OB. After he made a free throw, he got going. He struggled to shoot the ball, but once he saw it go through from the free throw line, he really got going. Now 3 opportunities for him as he misses the first, which the Wolfpack took tremendous advantage of at the line yesterday.
Red Autry, year number 1. Following a legend, never easy, but he's gotten Syracuse to 20 wins by winning 6 out of their last 9 at his alma mater.
And your alma mater.
Mine as well. So if you hear me leaning on that story of Syracuse still has a chance to get into the NCAA tournament.
I believe they do, absolutely. And when you consider the fact of how good this team has been, especially as of late, they should be in the mix for one of those automatic bids. Forgive me, not automatic bid, but an at-large bid.
Mintz on the attack, right up against a wall of red, and drops it in. Syracuse off to a nice start here with a 6-1 lead. Marcel on the wing. He will drive it. Syracuse collapsing on him. He can't connect. Diarra with a dribble down. Double fake, and it's blocked from behind. Brown got a hand on it and a whistle. And a foul here against Syracuse.
Judah Mintz attacking the basket, which he does so often. 7th nationally in free throw makes this season. He has no problem getting to the rim, putting his head down, and taking on all comers once he gets to the basket.
Justin Taylor with the foul. Burns gets the return. Working on Brown. That should be an entertaining duel as he hits that one.
And DJ Burns has that ability. He's getting a chance to play one-on-one versus Malik Brown. However, you see Judah Mintz camping out right in the middle of the lane. There will be someone in help position all the time waiting for the spin to the baseline from DJ Burns.
Starling with 26 against NC State in one of those victories. Mintz, tough shot, hits the deck. He does that an awful lot, but he bounces right back up and he heads to the line.
Yeah, he gets to the free throw line as much as anyone, but you see defensively, Judah Mintz just staying there waiting for DJ Burns to try to come baseline. DJ Burns sees him in his vision, but it's not a true double team, so you don't commit and give DJ Burns that passing lane.
Mintz has drawn a team-high 179 fouls. And he makes 77%. One of the games against NC State, he hit 14 foul shots and 18 tries.
Also led the ACC in free throw attempts. So when you have that happening from your point guard, you got a lot of respect for Judah Mintz, who's playing in front of a lot of friends and family right here at home.
Not to mention his former head coach. Great to see Jim Boeheim here working the tournament with you yesterday, Burns. And backs it in. He'll be headed to the line. The big fella looking for a three-point play.
But Chris Bell in that spot. It's almost like a spy on a quarterback. You don't double team until you see DJ Burns spin toward the baseline. But Bell gets there late, allows DJ Burns to get into a shooting motion, the contact, and the and one opportunity.
27 points against Duke. He was outstanding in that game. They lost the game. But he was certainly the focus time and time again. For a while, had Duke on the ropes there.
And OB, even going back to his game yesterday, he had 12 points, but he did it in 10 minutes and 41 seconds. So wasn't on the floor much, but was very productive in the time that he was.
The last foul was against Chris Bell. That's two on Bell, so he had to take a seat. As we talked about, he was out of his mind in the first half of the SU win at NC State with 26 points. Copeland has it batted away. Mintz grabs it. As we approach 16 minutes to go in the half. Mintz into that lane. Tried for a blind pass, tipped out by NC State. And Syracuse on top, 8-6. And we've got our first media break. Now the great, legendary Jim Boeheim is in the house. We're working him an awful lot here.
Hey, Jimmy Brackets is up for all the tasks that come his way.
Both head coaches trying to orchestrate some magic and maybe a run to the NCAA tournament. They still both have hopes. NC State with 18 wins, Syracuse at 20-11.
First ever ACC tournament head coaching game for Adrian Autry. Kevin Keats now in his seventh year, has a lot of experience on the sidelines for the Wolfpack.
Taylor gets it to Morcell. Morcell had it knocked away by Mintz and out of play. NC State, a team that rarely turns it over. Only about 10 per game. And here comes DJ Horn, and the Wolfpack fans are delighted by that. All ACC third team, 17 points per game, 43% from three. And the hip apparently is all right. We'll see just how good.
Well, he's not all right, but he's well enough to play, and that is a big factor for the Wolfpack, getting him back onto the floor, if only for the threat that he causes with his ability to shoot it at that 43% you mentioned.
Diarra shot by Morcell much too long. Copeland batting the rebound himself. Nice job there in the corner. Well, dear Copeland. No, Horn got back defensively there and harassing Copeland, knocks it away. So he looks bouncy.
Well, he's excited to be on the floor in the ACC tournament, but not as excited as this young man is. I can tell you right now, this is exactly what he was waiting for, to come to the ACC tournament in D.C. and see DJ Horn.
Have any of us ever been that excited about anything?
I'm not sure.
Winning the lottery. Copeland bottled up downstairs, got the pass free somehow. Taylor couldn't hit the shot. Amazing he got that pass free. The long jumper will be nothing but net by O'Connell.
And O'Connell was super aggressive yesterday. 16 points for him with the absence of Horn. And I'm thinking he wants to try to continue that level of aggressiveness even with DJ Horn on the floor.
Starling. A little too much on that one. He's 33% from three-point distance. NC State jumping in front on the triple. Diarra will swing it out. Morcell had a lot of iron but wouldn't fall. Welcome you to Washington, D.C., Capital One Arena, round two of the ACC tournament. Dave O'Brien alongside Corey Alexander and Angel Gray. NC State, the number 10 seed. Syracuse, the number 7 seed. DJ Horn, the star for the Wolfpack, who did not play last night, has gotten into this game in the last minute and a half as Mohamed Diarra makes the basket to put NC State in front. So, Corey, early on, back and forth.
It's been very back and forth. I'm not sure that was a conventional drive to the basket by Diarra, but it still counts for two. But both of these teams, with Syracuse sweeping thus far the season series, but trying to beat a good team three times, always difficult.
NC State at 18-14. Syracuse 20 wins, 11 losses. Shot clock down to two. Brown will launch it and got it to go. Talk about unconventional.
Again, Malik Brown showing Mo Diarra, if you want to be unconventional, I can do the same. This late at night, the bank is still open.
Any weird thing you can do, I can do even weirder. DJ Horn with it here. Such an explosive scorer when he's 100%. He's not right now with a hip situation. Cost him last night's game. But they won anyway. Diarra got it downstairs. Middlebrooks getting in strong and can't connect.
Malik Brown clearing the rebound, and these two guys going at it. You see Quadir Copeland and DJ Horn. However, before the game, those guys were dapping each other up, hugging, talking to each other. But once you step on this court between these four lines, it doesn't matter how good of friends you are. It's all about the competition.
Yeah, I'm sure you were there in your days at Virginia. You played against a really good friend. What was that like?
Oh, yeah. You talking about when I was cooking Randolph Childress out here in the ACC tournament? Well, you want to go to that?
You okay. Said it.
Maybe that's what you were referring to.
I think you're going to get some sort of response, but probably on social media would be my guess. Your Texas is about to explode.
He's watching. He'll be texting. But show me the lie. That's all. Show me the lie.
I know it's all in love. It's all in friendship. Unless you're out here, though. He's 90 feet.
And once you get out here, again, and you've got a lot of friends in this game, we all grew up playing against each other, and we choose our different schools, and your friends off the court. But everybody wants to win in the tournament.
Vince got airborne, wasn't exactly sure what to do with it. Syracuse by two. Now the winner faces number 2 seed Duke tomorrow at 7 p.m. here in Washington. Top 4 seeds get double byes as that one will rattle away. The Orange, a team that can really score when they get it rolling. They get 77 points a game. Last 8 or 9 games, they've really been piling up the points. At 94 against Louisville, at 86 against North Carolina. 11:49 to go here in the first half. 13-11, Syracuse leading NC State.
This is when it was all love, OB. DJ Horn, Quadir Copeland, it was all love there. However, no love lost here between the four lines at the ACC tournament.
ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by T. Rowe Price. Invest with confidence. And in part by AutoZone. Get in the zone. A great history at NC State. I mean, Jim Valvano, 1983. Who will ever forget that? Do yourself a favor if you don't know it. Google that run by NC State Jimmy V. From the ACC tournament on to the national championship in 83.
And during the golden era of the ACC, not only knocking off North Carolina, but also Virginia and Ralph Sampson, ending Ralph Sampson's ACC career. But that may not have been the best NC State national championship run. The 1974 team in an ACC tournament played what is known as the greatest ACC game of all time, beating Maryland, where only one team can go to the NCAA tournament. Of course, the Wolfpack went on to win the national championship in 1974.
Terrific history. Mintz on the attack will draw the foul. NCAA 11:29 to go, and that'll go against.
Oh, look who's here. That will be my guy, Derek Wittenberg.
How about that?
Who still claims that it was a pass, although we know it was a shot. The late Lorenzo Charles with the nice alley-oop.
And it was history.
And it was history with Jim Valvano running across the floor looking for someone to hug.
Great visual there. Copeland launches and swishes it in. But Eric Copeland, only 26% out there, but He was gigantic in one of their victories at NC State this year. 25 points, 8 rebounds.
And Claudia Copeland also was an ACC Player of the Week after his performance against Pittsburgh and was second in the running for sixth man of the year.
Vince Tough Leaner, and that was in the cylinder. So no basket. Let's go to Angel.
Guys, as we're about halfway through the first half, going in back to NC State's game last night, Coach Keats was talking about what needed to carry over. He said, I love the way my team was sharing the ball. They had 14 total assists. All but one player had an assist after the night. Right now, they're sitting at one, shooting below 30%. So the energy of the ball right now is what they're lacking to start the half.
Yeah, Angel, and one of the things, of course, to get an assist, you've got to make the shot. And the problem with that is North Carolina State, 4 of 14 from the field, only 1 for 7. From beyond the arc. A beautiful find from DJ Burns. And this time, Jaden Taylor's able to knock down the three ball.
Transferred to NC State after 2 years at Butler. He was a good scorer. He's about 13 points a game and averaging about 12 for Kevin Keats.
But he's been a great scorer as of late, OB, averaging 19 points a game over his last 5-18 in their matchup yesterday.
Copeland straight on. Got a good look, but off the back of that iron. Let's see if Horn gets involved offensively. Burns with a touch. What a tough angle, but he makes a lot of those shots.
I'll tell you what, he's had a huge impact to start this game. This North Carolina State team is different when DJ Burns is on the floor. You have a post player to be able to play through, but he's so unselfish that you have to pick your poison. Do you double team, or do you just allow him to just beat you up one-on-one?
A creative passer, too. Mintz lofts it, gets it, and he'll go to the line. Judah Mintz with a response and looking for a three-point play. Fouled again.
We talked about Judah Mintz's ability to be able to get to the free throw line. This time he'll only get one opportunity because he has the concentration through the contact to still be able to knock down the mid-range jumper. And Judah Mintz off to a great start. 8 points for him already. 3 of 6 from the field, 2 of 2 at the line.
Now you can't say the same thing about DJ Horn. That's his second foul, and he has to go to the bench. And in fact, he is going to go down the tunnel, maybe. Yeah, he is headed toward their locker room.
But once you get warmed up, especially when you're dealing with the injury, you get warmed up, you have to stay warmed up. Difficult at this point for DJ Horn to go sit down and try to come back in starting the second half. Most likely with the two fouls, he won't play the remainder of this first. Have to find a way to keep heat on that hip flexor.
O'Connell from the elbow can't hit it. Syracuse in transition. How about that pass? Brown with the slam, but Mintz with the dime.
Yes, and Judah Mintz puts on the goggles after the pass.
And then a steal by Mintz. Gives it away, Taylor. No foul on that one. Here comes Jaden Taylor on the opposite end of the floor, trying to go end to end, and NC State will clean it up.
But I love the consistency. I love the consistency. There was no call on one end for Justin Taylor. There's no call on the other end. Played completely the same way defensively by both big men staying vertical. So no call for either Taylor. But Diarra there with the second chance points.
DJ Horn, we gave a shot of that. Back to the bench. But again, 8.5 minutes before the break. And the pull-up won't fall. Copeland off the mark. Syracuse by 3. O'Connell coming in, 29% beyond the three-point line. Burns trying to get a better spot, and he once again gets great bounce and that terrific ability to find the goal.
And OB, Malik Brown is a first-team all-defensive player in the ACC, and it's nothing against Malik Brown, but if there was ever a time to use the he's too small signal,
yes,
that's it. He is too small to guard DJ Burns.
Many are.
Yes, this is true. He should not feel alone in that.
Right. He'll give it to O'Connell for a triple. Got it. Michael O'Connell on target. And NC State on a 7-0 run.
But Adrian Autry having a conversation with Cup. When you leave, as we watch Judah Mintz getting out in transition, you see the point guard eyes as he drops the dime to Malik Brown, who drops the hammer. And, of course, Judah Mintz showing off his goggles on the way back down the floor. Michael Cuff making a tremendous mistake defensively as you see him go after a basketball that he should not do.
7:37 to go before the break. And Starling will bring it up now for Syracuse. And among their victories this season, a 2 over NC State. So trying to make it 3 this season. They beat the Wolfpack by 4 at NC State, by 12 inside the dome.
Obi, we saw Adrian Autry getting upset at one of his defenders giving up the 3 as we see the travel by Taylor. As we get an opportunity to go back and look, Michael Cuff, as you watch him trying to go after the basketball, when you have a great passer like DJ Burns, you cannot gamble. Burns will make you pay for it each and every time. As he does, O'Connell knocks down the 3 ball. But look at Adrian Autry. Look at Coach. He is heated right now, OB, waiting.
Taylor on the other end, knocked away by Mintz to prevent a dunk. Yeah, he was heated all right. He was also caught in Corey's cone, which is another place you really never want to be.
Well, I can tell you right now, his mentor is here in the building watching that, and I'm certain he was proud of Adrian Autry for making sure to meet Cuff on the floor to let him know his displeasure in the defensive gamble that did not pay off.
Roussel kept the foot down, but the shot won't drop. Mintz charging out of there. Taylor taking a lane with that left hand. No. Brown tried to scoop it up. Loose ball again and taken in by Starling. And Syracuse will set it up. Copeland. Shot clock down to 7. Starling from the elbow. Got it.
And that's been the difference, in my opinion, OB, in this Syracuse team in the second half of the season. J.J. Starling has had 15 consecutive games in double figures. He was not looking to be aggressive early, but he has found his offense complementing Judah Mintz in that backcourt.
D.J. Burns trying to zip the pass inside and a whistle.
And Adrian Autry talking to his team, letting them know they have to either decide whether to come fully with the double team.
Well, coming up on Sunday, Selection Sunday. It all starts at 6. SportsCenter and ESPN. Reese and the guys look at the men's field of 68 as the brackets are announced, followed by bracketology, breakdowns of each region. At 8, the women's field is revealed with bracketology as well, and a complete breakdown immediately following.
And DJ Horn back on the floor playing with those 2 fouls. Had a good look off of a DJ Burns find.
Nifty spin there by Copeland. Couldn't get the basket, but he'll be headed to the line. But here Copeland, the sophomore from Philly. And fouled on the play by Jaden Taylor, who picks up number 1. Yeah, good to see Horn back on.
Well, and one of the things for Kevin Keats, it's difficult once he gets going to sit him down. When you're dealing with the hip flexor, now you're talking about getting stiff. And now to be able to come back and play in the second half would be, you know, virtually impossible if you do tighten up. So I respect Kevin Keats getting him back on the floor, but also trusting his fifth-year guard to make sure he doesn't pick up that 3rd foul.
Have you ever played with anything like that?
I have. I've had pretty much every injury you can imagine. So, and I work with the hip flexor daily right now.
Burns at the line. Getting a little bit closer, a little fall away. Oh, big rebound by Diar. Got it to O'Connell on the low block for 2. And that was all Muhammad Diarra.
And if you look at what has been the issue for the Orange throughout this season, they've been out-rebounded by 6.6 rebounds a game in ACC play. That is where they struggle. We talked about they don't have the largest front line and the size to match up with NC State.
Tell you what, there's a lot of Orange in this building.
The Orange travel.
Yeah, they certainly do.
The Orange travel well.
And here for the ACC tournament, looking for a bit of a magic carpet ride. Mintz had it knocked away. Still a loose ball. He hits the deck, kept the dribble. He'll heave it up there. And it was a shot clock violation. He did not get up in time anyway.
Quadir Copeland doing a great job keeping Judah Mintz away from the official. And right now, Judah Mintz fortunate. Quadir Copeland may have saved him from a technical foul on that possession.
Up playing with a lot of fire. The officials are Roger Ayers, Tony Henderson, and Jamel Spearman.
Yeah, Tony Henderson was very lenient on that possession. Give Tony a lot of credit because it would have been easy to hit Judah Mintz with a technical foul on that.
O'Connell on the dribble. Taylor trying that baseline. Tough sledding underneath, but he made the shot. That was a brutally tough shot.
Yeah, and Taylor, not just a shooter, showing off his ability to attack the basket and finish through contact.
So NC State by two. We're going back and forth and back and forth. Might be that way all night here in Washington.
We hope so, right, OB?
Absolutely. Copeland. Seven to shoot it. Working on Marcel, now a double. Taylor came over to help. Shot clock is down to one. Mintz has to get it up, can't hit it. And Syracuse knocked it out off Taylor's hand.
Judah Mintz hesitated on that shot, looking at the shot clock. When you know you got to get a shot up, that's a confident time to be able to shoot it. There's nothing else for you to do. Just catch it and shoot it, knowing that shot clock is down under 3 seconds.
So the Wolfpack with the ball up by two. They had dropped four in a row before their win yesterday over Louisville. And turnovers were such a big part of that.
It absolutely was.
On the drive and scooped up and in by J.J. Starling. Mentioned he had 26 against NC State. One of the wins at 22 against Miami, 23 against North Carolina. Syracuse buckling down defensively. Mintz gives it up. Here's Starling from the corner. He'll get a second chance. Starling can't finish. On the run.
Nice find.
Taylor will draw the foul. 3:24 to go before the break here at Capital One, second round of the ACC tournament. ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Principal. Let our expertise round out yours.
What's up? That's Tom. I'm Dallin. Pump halftime. We will recap the ACC games from earlier in the day. Also, maybe a quick look at Pitt and Wake Forest in tomorrow's 4-5 matchup. Also, the Big 12 in action. We should have highlights there. Here, tight one. Clearly tied up.
Absolutely. Keep going into DJ Burns. Let him pass. Let him play. He's playing with tremendous quickness tonight. They've got to do a better job at NC State, though, keeping Syracuse out of the paint. A lot of pull-ups. They're a little too open.
The dancing bear. Always a problem. So is CA and OB. Back to you.
You ain't lying, Dallin. Thank you. Coach Crean, thank you very much. See you guys at halftime. And for more on Mohamed Diarra, the big junior from France, let's toss it over to Angel.
As every team has mentioned the importance of nutrition and refueling during this tournament, but those who are also recognizing Ramadan for the next month are put in an even more unique situation. NC State's Mohamed Diarra actually is currently fasting, which means he will not eat from sun up to sun down. The team's dietitian, Jesse McGinley, stated that he had a big meal last night, ate around 5:45 this morning, and won't eat or drink anything. That's including water until sunset in D.C., which was marked at 7:14 tonight. They started pushing fluids and food during the timeout of this game. So that's something to keep your mind on, how he's finding that energy for tonight's game.
Well, Angel, I can remember playing against a guy who DJ Burns has taken a lot of his footwork from, by the name of Akeem Olajuwon, mm-hmm. who also used to observe Ramadan. And I can tell you now, OB, he was just as good during Ramadan as he was any other time. He was spectacular.
Always. NC State with the ball here and on top by two, coming down the home stretch of the first half. Here's Diarra with it as he puts it to the deck. Hunting a shot here off the fake.
You see the difference for Malik Brown, an elite defender, and how you take on someone like Diarra in comparison to how he has to guard DJ Burns. And the difference in the pressure that DJ Burns puts on your defense.
Marcel will pick up his first foul.
And DJ Burns, who's played more minutes already in this first half tonight than he did in the entire game yesterday, has had a huge impact. 9 points, 2 assists already. More importantly, 0 turnovers.
Mintz left alone to fire it up there, and that's not a good idea.
And that's what Coach Kareem was talking about in studio. That's too easy for Judah Mintz. That's, you know, you get him to 16, 17 feet. That's a layup for Judah Mintz to be able to knock that down with no defense.
Sophomore from Fort Washington, Maryland. Good first half with 11. Middlebrooks will hand it off for Taylor. Taylor trying to shred the D, going in strong. He's made a couple of really tough buckets.
He absolutely has, but a lot of that has to do with the fact that outside of Malik Brown, there's not much rim protection for the Orange. Justin Taylor at 6'6", trying to man the post in there. And Jaden Taylor not concerned about Justin Taylor, who was, of course, a wing coming out of high school, trying to block his shot.
NC State holding off Louisville, and a stunning performance by Sky Clark, 36 points yesterday. 94-85 victory for the Pack to advance. And that was without their top scorer, DJ Horn. They iced the win with 11 foul shots in the last 3 minutes. Made a ton of foul shots.
Yeah, they absolutely did. And it was this young man, Casey Marcel, who made 13 for 13. Ooh. And this time he goes to the tough bucket, the turnaround over great defense by Clear Copeland.
25 against Louisville for him. He was a big star in NC State with a 33-29 lead. Coming up on a minute to go before halftime. A handoff from Mintz. Now Starling. Starling with a pull-up pop and drains that one to triple.
Obi, you mentioned in the open, J.J. Starling averaging 19.5 points a game versus NC State. This is a team that he has a lot of confidence playing against, and a lot of that has to do with you take your best defender and you normally put him on Judah Mintz. So he's getting to play against the second best defender, and he's had his way.
Marcel looking to make a move on the spin. Copeland got a hand on it to follow, and a foul against Syracuse. 38.7 left in the half.
You've seen some great battles. Casey Marcel, Quadir Copeland going at it. Marcel winning this battle, going to the step back. And then J.J. Starling, rhythm dribble off the screen and roll action, knocking down a three ball. He's been a different player as far as his confidence shooting the basketball during the last half of the season.
Malik Brown just picked up foul number 2. So he's going to sit here for the rest of the half. And Peter Carey's 6'11 sophomore in for the first time out of Sunderland, Massachusetts. Middlebrooks at the line. The junior transfer from Clemson. And we will see the Tigers later on tonight against Boston College.
Yeah. And you'll see Jack Clark, who was a member of the North Carolina State Wolfpack last year. So there's been rumored that that was actually a trade between the two teams.
Right.
Middlebrooks for Jack Clark straight up.
Copeland tried to dart a pass inside and stolen away. Diarra comes up with it. 12 seconds before halftime, 12.3, and a timeout to set up a shot here for NC State. Leading Syracuse here 35-32 in round two. Hey, coming up tonight, 11:30 Eastern on the ACC Network, the Nothing But Net crew will have a complete breakdown of today's second round ACC tournament games. Some great action earlier today. Florida State 86-76 over Virginia Tech. Wake Forest, a must win for Wake, as the number 5 seed knocking off Notre Dame 72-59. Last seconds of the half.
The switch up by Syracuse going to the zone out of the timeout.
They want Burns to touch it, flips it up there, and rolls off the 10. And that's the last shot of the half. NC State will head to the locker room leading Syracuse here in round 2, 35-32.
I love the adjustment by Adrian Archer, though, going to the zone, getting a stop on that last possession. Kevin Keats hadn't seen the zone throughout this game, so a great switch up. And Syracuse gets a stop.
Angel with Coach Keats.
Coach, you said you wanted to establish your inside presence early. Burns right now with 9 early points. What would you assess how he's been able to do so far?
Well, I thought our guys did a good job finding him. We thought we had advantage going into the game, and we've been able to get the ball inside. And then a couple times that they decided to double him, he found open people. So he's playing well. We got to play the game inside out.
Speaking of playing well, Judah Mintz right now looks like he's in a rhythm. How can you disrupt that in the second half?
You know, he's a tough matchup, and we're backing all, you know, daring him to take a three. But he's got like 15-foot pull-up jump shots that we got to do a good job contesting.
Thanks, Coach.
Thank you.
NC State got a really nice first half out of Jayden Taylor, as he wound up with 10, Burns with 9. So it's NC State by 3 at the break. Right now, back to the studio, our guys, Dallin Cuff and Tom Crean.
Thanks, OB. 3-point lead for the Wolfpack at the break. Let's get you caught up with our Champ Week action. We start with the second game of the day in the ACC tournament, maybe the biggest one. Wake Forest currently on the outside looking in per Joe Lunardi in the NCAA tournament. Cam Hildreth with the steal, going the other way.
Well, they played with desperation. There is absolutely no doubt about it. Great play by Cam Hildreth. He was much better, much more aggressive in the second half.
And bear in mind, this is a Notre Dame team that beat Wake just a couple weeks ago. It started a 3-game skid that took them off the right side of the bubble. As Fredrickson hits a big shot, he made some big plays in this game, but in the end, Wake was just too much.
They did. They turned it off. They turned Notre Dame over. They were so good in the second half, defending the three, getting them off the three-point line, and challenging shots in the paint.
Let's go to FSU, Virginia Tech. This is the 8-9 game, and down by 3. Tyler Nickel hits the 3, gives the Hokies a tie, and then the problem is, Coach, turnovers was a huge issue.
Oh, yeah, that was a ridiculous pass. Look at Primo Spears just outrun it, get in, get to the paint. Bucket. When they're playing with quickness at Florida State, playing with aggressiveness, playing the switch game the right way, they are effective. And that's pretty effective too, Dallin. Jameer Watkins was phenomenal today.
Yeah, we'll get some more Jameer in here. He had 34 points. First time he's gone over 30 in his career. Did it at the right time. They move on to take on North Carolina, the 1-9 matchup, the ACC champ. The big one, many people think the Pitt and Wake Forest may be a play-in game, as Joe Lunardi has them both on the wrong side of the bubble. You think they're both in, though?
I do. I really do. I think they both deserve to be in. I don't think tomorrow's a play-in game. I think when you look at what they've done, when you look at the league, and plus, I think the league is going to get 6 teams in.
ACC country, Tom Crean. You can't add him they're going to love that. Yeah. 6 teams, Coach thinks.
I didn't
right
say,
now.
Again, that it's they deserve it. I said I think that's what's going to happen.
Okay, we'll find out. Virginia also is a team.
But I wouldn't be shocked at all.
Per Joe Lunardi, that they play, obviously, tomorrow as the 4 seed.
I don't think we're going to get 7.
Okay. All right. No, he doesn't think 7. Think about this game, though. What do you think about NC State start here up a couple?
I think we just heard it from Kevin Keats. He's exactly right. It's a simple halftime. You've got to keep the ball out of the paint by guarding the first dribble better. Judah Mintz is getting anywhere he wants to go, and J.J. Starling hasn't gotten started yet. So you've got to do a better job there. Obviously, Justin Taylor can make threes. Guard the ball, challenge shots in the paint, but put up a big screen picture of D.J. Burns and say, we are going into him every time. That doesn't mean he's going to shoot it every time. He's one of the most underrated passers in the ACC and certainly in college basketball because he plays so quick. Watch this pass inside. Look how quick he gets this up. That is a big man making a quick play like that. Against Duke, he had 27 points, 4 assists, which turned into 9 points. It doesn't matter if you double him. If you play him in single coverage, he's going to score. If you play him in a double coverage, he's going to kick it out. Then they just have to make the shots.
Yeah, he's added a huge effect on this game and helping the Wolfpack get the lead. Other big news in the ACC today, unfortunately, it seemed like a foregone conclusion. Kenny Payne is out as the head coach of Louisville after 2 seasons, a 12-52 record.
Well, Kenny Payne is a really, really good man who has been respected not only for his recruiting ability all these years, but for his player development. And he did an outstanding job with guys like Brandon Huntley Hatfield, Caleb Glenn. He just did not have enough of the guard play. They did not have enough shooting. It's a tough deal, but he'll bounce back.
Coach is dancing bear in slow-mo, baby.
Look at that. Oh, a little bit of a high dribble. We got to get that corrected, DJ. But love the quickness. Look at that release. Picture perfect. That's a Cisco's video right there. Sell it.
Look at the Syracuse band was in awe of the dancing bear.
It'll be a short-lived enjoyment factor right there. You will be upset to your stomach.
Let's go. Upset to your stomach. Well, Syracuse fans may be too if they can't turn this around the second half.
Judah Mintz, they still got him. They got to guard him better at NC State this half.
The slow-mo bumps. Second half next.
Give me a
Back in our nation's capital, you're watching ESPN's Champ Week presented by Principal. This is the ACC Men's Basketball Tournament presented by T. Rowe Price. Getting ready for the second half. NC State on top 35-32 over Syracuse. And now for tonight's Expert Moves brought to you by Principal.
Well, the expert move is by NC State's DJ Burns. However, Justin Taylor caught in the middle, not really double teaming. And when you're going to play this way against an elite passer like DJ Burns, you're going to pay for it. DJ Burns delivers a strike to Jayden Taylor, who knocks down the three ball. But Syracuse has battled back with Judah Mintz manning the point, dropping dimes, delivering the strike to Malik Brown in transition. DJ Burns on the other end. Defender caught in between, double teaming or not. And then Judah Mintz just one-on-one is difficult to guard, especially when he's knocking down the mid-range jumper.
Mintz with 11 and a couple of assists. Burns with 9 for NC State, but Jayden Taylor led them with 10. As we are underway here in the second half, NC State with the ball.
Syracuse starting in the zone defensively, OB, to start this second half.
Over the top, Mintz. Oh, what a pretty catch and bucket.
And you are very familiar with this, as of course you're a Syracuse alum. The zone oftentimes forces a lot of turnovers. Syracuse has been notorious for leading the league in steals with under Jim Boeheim when they were playing the zone. Adrian Autry now going to the zone here to start this second half after they have two back-to-back turnovers for NC State, who only had 2 in the first half.
Mm-hmm. And usually do a great job of holding on to the ball. So Syracuse within 1. And again, the winner to take on the 2 seed, the Duke Blue Devils. We've got the double bye to get into the quarterfinals. Bell on target. Now, he was in foul trouble. Set a huge chunk of the first half.
But that's his role. He's the shooter on this team. And great execution to get him a look early. Missed the final 16 minutes of that first half, but knocked down his first 3 here.
So, great sign for the Orange there. He'll jump in. And a whistle here with 18:52 to go, second half. Give a look at the shot chart on DJ Burns, the 6'9 grad.
He was super efficient in the first half, OB, scoring and also dishing. North Carolina State is a much better team when they get the basketball in the hand of DJ Burns, and more importantly, when he's able to stay on the floor and out of foul trouble.
That incidentally was foul number 3 on Chris Bell. And DJ Horn back in for the Wolfpack. He missed last night's game because of a hip issue. He was in and out of the lineup in the first half of this one. Did not start for the Wolfpack. Mintz with a pull up, drains it.
So he's just getting to his spots, OB. He's so athletic. Once he gets to his spots, he's going to elevate. There's nothing you can do as a defender if you don't get to the basketball when he's on the ground.
He has 15 points. He's hit a bunch of shots just like that. Horn with a pull up at the elbow, and that'll go. Good sign for the Wolfpack to see him hit a jump shot, his first basket.
And I like the way Kevin Keyes didn't wait nearly as long in within the first 2 minutes of this second half.
Mintz driving, and DeAr going up hard with a rejection. Let's check in with Angel.
Coach Autry has to be pleased with how his team is playing and starting off the second half. He told me earlier, he said, we have to do a better job of taking care of the ball. They had 7 turnovers in the first half. He said, right now we're not taking great shots. We have to make sure we're connected. Right now we're seeing that in the second half.
And Angel, for you as a former point guard, you can only imagine how much that drives Adrian Autry crazy as a former point guard himself.
You want to be the floor general. You want to make sure that everybody is in the right place and with the right pace.
Taylor pulls up and pops. DeAr had position, and he will draw the foul. The 6'10 junior gets hit. Tied at 39. That foul will go against Justin Taylor, number 2. 1992 Big East Tournament champion as a player.
I'm surprised at how many times I've referred to him as Adrian Autry throughout this game.
Instead of Red,
because I know him as Red, of course, and know him from that 1992 team where he, alongside Archbishop Carroll alum Lawrence Moten, won that 1992 Big East tournament. Lawrence Moten, of course, leaving as the Big East all-time leading scorer, who happens to be from the D.C. area.
You know your D.C. better than anyone I've ever met. And so many great players have come from here.
So many great players coming from this area, OB.
including, we talk Syracuse, the Pearl. Sorry, not Pearl. Sherman Douglas, all-time leading assist in the NCAA when he left Syracuse program.
Many great Syracuse players under Jim Boeheim, of course. On the move, Starling. Taylor twisted that pass inside, but a shot clock will fire off here. So that'll go back over to NC State.
Roger Ayers underneath the basket on that call, but his least favorite call in the game, OB, is a shot clock violation. Because Roger Ayers refuses to touch the top of his hair. It is not going to happen.
By the way, does anybody wear better shoes in all of college basketball than Roger does?
It's not just the shoes. It's the entire outfit. He gives me a rundown,
Burns,
every game.
Off the window, no. DR came crashing in. Still a loose ball and a wild scramble for it in the lane there. 17:04 to go. 41-39.
There's my guy. Stays sharp. It's Roger Ayers. And again, of course, he's got his traditional outfit on, as you see DJ Burns going to the basket, unable to finish it, but the scrum underneath trying to get the loose ball.
NC State off the inbounds. Morsell, great interior passing, and Burns will knock it down.
Great recognition by Diarra, though, to know that as the help comes over, DJ Burns is going to be able to seal his defender and get the easy layup.
DJ with 11. Mintz at the foul line. Can't drain that one. And Diarra with the rebound. NC State did not come to Washington, D.C., a hot team. They had lost four straight, but played very well against Louisville. Big scoring game as they got 94. And they're trying to make it two for two. Batted away by Mintz. Shot clock down to 7. Right back to Taylor. Now Burns on the high post. Trying to spin and a lot of iron, but it won't drop. He wins it back. Somehow a second effort and switched in by Taylor. That was a crazy possession.
It was a crazy possession. However, it shows you the great hands of DJ Burns. He was off balance, has got a shot up on the glass, but was unable to corral the offensive rebound, but getting his hands on it allowed Jayden Taylor to find the three. And that three that Taylor knocks down sends the Wolfpack on a 9-0 run. The great DeMatha Catholic High School, the standard of high school basketball, not just in the DMV, but throughout the country. What Morgan Wooten created, and of course, North Carolina State legends, Derek Wittenberg, Sidney Lowe, also hailing from DeMatha Catholic. OB, one of the best to ever do it. Jim Boeheim yesterday said that Morgan Wooten was one of the best coaches ever. Regardless of high school, college, NBA, he was one of the best coaches of all time.
Wow, what a tribute. So many great players coming out of that program. At the prep level, wild pass there, but it'll be tipped out of play. 15:45 to go, and we've got a timeout. 46-39. That is PJ Hall, the Clemson star, about to enter the fray of the ACC tournament, taking on Boston College at 9:30 on ESPNU. ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is brought to you by Principal. Let our expertise round out yours. Syracuse and NC State toe-to-toe here in round number two, our first of the night session. Dave O'Brien alongside Corey Alexander and Angel Gray. What are your thoughts so far about the tournament? Wake Forest with a huge win today as far as their chances for the NCAA tournament.
And a necessary win to set up what will be an absolute battle tomorrow with the Pitt Panthers in that 4-5 matchup as J.J. Starling's able to get to the mid-range. Adrian Archery now coming back man-to-man out of the timeout. NC State figured out their way through that zone.
DJ Horn trying to get free, airborne, knocks it down. We haven't heard much from him in this game. He came in averaging 17 with a bunch of big games. 4 points. Starling will slice in. Bit of a wild shot and a tie up on the play and a whistle. So we'll give you a look at the tickets punched so far. And as we are into round two of the ACC tournament. Among those, James Madison. St. Mary's with a huge win over Gonzaga last night in the WCC championship.
Yeah, great win for the Gales and also Longwood. So two Virginia teams, Longwood and James Madison, already punching their tickets. Of course, you know, always got to keep up with my state.
You are the governor. or will be someday. I have no doubt you'll get out the vote. Starling and blocked from behind by Taylor. So a shutdown for the Wolfpack. We'll lead at 48-41. Horn will launch way downtown, but too strong.
But another offensive rebound, OB. That's been the difference. Now 17 second chance points for the Wolfpack in this game.
Diarra, 12 rebounds. Six of those, to your point, offensive rebounds.
Yeah, he's been all over the glass. But we talk about the smaller front line of the Orange.
Line driver by Bell won't fall. Well, now the Wolfpack starting to think about really taking control of this thing at the 14-minute mark. Horn for Burns. And a whistle there. And another foul. Syracuse picks up another foul. This one on Copeland is second. And their 13 foul.
Obi, what Syracuse has allowed to happen without having to attack DJ Burns offensively, they'd allow him to stay on the floor. And we know that NC State's a different team when he's on the floor, but he hasn't had to do much on the defensive end, allowing him to save his energy for what he does so well offensively.
The big gets it down to Diarra. Low pass from Roussel. Shot clock is at 5. And a deflection here. That was with 4.3 on the shot clock.
And you knew DJ Burns has to have something to say to Mo Diarra. Shoot the basketball. He dropped him a dime. Diarra threw it out to the corner in comparison to going up strong and dunking that. I knew DJ was going to have words for him.
Shot clock reset to 20. Diarra flipped up and hung on the iron for the longest time. Syracuse wants to run. Mintz on the attack. Can't finish that. NC State got back quickly defensively.
OB, DJ Horn did not realize that it was that they had a 14-second reset of the shot clock, but you see DJ Burns does realize that Mo Diarra needs to shoot the basketball when he drops him a dime. He wants him to go up strong and finish that.
Copeland, that spits free right to Horn. NC State by 9. E.J. Horn looking for room to operate. It's partially blocked. Burns comes away with it, though. He'll get a chance at it. Now it'll be swished in by Taylor.
Offensive rebound. Kick out for 3. Always the best time to shoot the 3. The entire defense is in the paint trying to come away with the rebound. They don't get it. D.J. Burns, an elite-level passer, finds Jaden Taylor and knocks down the 3 ball.
Look at this run. 16-2 over the last 6 minutes. Theft. Horn to Taylor, back to Horn, and he'll lay it in. And a big-time fast break. That'll bring in a timeout, Syracuse. NC State. Mintz a little bit shaken up. 55-41, the Pack. Well, Judah Mintz upset moments ago. After there was no foul called here, looked like there was plenty of contact, but his reaction after that, he was really upset, obviously shaken up, but then complaining to an official, an unsportsmanlike technical, as he complained to Tony Henderson, who teed him up.
But if we go back to the first half, Tony Henderson was very lenient with Judah Mintz. On a possession where Judah Mintz actually went back in the direction of Tony Henderson, Cordia Copeland stepped in to keep him away from getting that technical foul. Tony Henderson had enough, and of course, you cannot show up an official, especially with everyone watching the team on the bench. And then Judah Mitchell clearly frustrated, and rightfully so. However, that's a possession of a play where he has to keep his cool, because now you give NC State an opportunity to put points on the board at the free throw line and the basketball back.
And they get the ball as well. 82%. DJ Horn missing the first one. But this game, in the process of flipping big time in the Wolfpack's favor, Horn making one of two. And Mintz continues to get some treatment. Obviously upset, but I think you make a great point about the official gave him room in the first half.
And again, if not for the incident in the first half, Tony Henderson may have walked away. I mean, he understands the frustration. I mean, officials miss calls. It happens.
Horn with the theft. Horn will dunk it. A giant swing here in the last 3 or 4 minutes.
I'm going to say the hip flexor feels pretty good for DJ Horn right now.
Entry pass inside for Brown and two. 58-43. That snapped a 12-0 run. Here's Taylor to swoop in, and now the Pack making all kinds of shots.
I'll tell you what, with this backcourt, the way they're playing right now, this NC State team is dangerous.
Bell off the fake, a three on the way, but no. Horn up ahead for Marcel.
Even more dangerous when this guy has the basketball in his hand.
Burns on the baseline, taps his own miss. The Orange come away. They need a long run. Copeland off to Bell. Bell will swish in the triple.
He's the one guy that the Orange have been able to rely on to knock down threes consistently throughout this year. They're going to need a lot more of that now, trailing by 14 after North Carolina State has dominated the offensive glass and shared the basketball extremely well.
Syracuse needs a lot more of that. Remember, though, Bell hit 8 threes and a half against NC State earlier this winter. The swing for Marcel, around and out, one and done. And
another great look and great find from DJ Burns.
Copeland, long strides in there for a basket. And now Syracuse kind of picking themselves up off the deck here.
They absolutely are, and they're following the lead of Quadir Copeland, who is the energizer. He's the guy that brings the vocal leadership for the Orange. And they've gotten it back to 12. Judah Mintz on the bench as he's watched Quadir Copeland get his team back in the game.
So a mini 5-0 run here. DJ Horn, yeah, showing the bounce he's been known for all season long. Nice little run here for the Wolfpack, trying to get back in this thing. Plenty of time, 10:43 to go. You're watching ESPN's Champ Week, presented by Principal. This is the ACC Men's Basketball Tournament, presented by T. Rowe Price. Well, the top four seeds waiting in the wings. North Carolina, Pitt, Duke, and Virginia. North Carolina number one, Duke number two, Virginia number three, Pitt number four. North Carolina back in action at noon tomorrow against Florida State.
OB, I love Tuesday and Wednesday of the ACC tournament, but it's a different energy on Thursday. When the big boys come in, it is a completely different energy. And, of course, the followings for those top four seeds will tear the roof off this building.
It'll be the quarterfinals here at Capital One Arena. Shot clock to six. Diarra. That's going to be an offensive as Bell went down. He took the hit. Diarra's first foul.
Now, one thing I am concerned about, OB, is if my young guy, when he enters the building tomorrow, will Armando be wearing this shower cap? That is a concern. I'm sure he's watching, and I am concerned about my boy with the shower cap on. I'm not quite sure how that happened.
Well, I can guess how it happened. He was ready. He was preparing for the champagne. And he was prepared. I give him credit for that. Bell straight on. Sinks it. A two-pointer.
Just like that. It's a 10-point game, OB. NC State made a tremendous run. However, the Orange have really been inspired since the technical foul from Judah Mintz. Even though Mintz is on the bench, Quadir Copeland has come in and taken over.
Roycel shut down in the paint. O'Connell got a good look. He's a dangerous shooter when he gets warmed up.
Big basket from O'Connell, really, to stop a little bit of the momentum from the Orange as Judah Mintz steps back to the scores table, ready to check back into this one.
So is Jaden Taylor, who's played a fine game and hit 28 against Pittsburgh last weekend. Copeland trying to work it too far underneath, and the pass comes free to the Wolfpack. O'Connell will swing it. Roycel coming off 25. They double up on him. Here's O'Connell again. Shot clock at 14. DJ Horn did not score in the first half. He has 11 in the second half. That hip's feeling better. Another shot from him. And knocks back a three.
Obi, I believe he used the first half to warm up. He's here now. I believe he has arrived.
DJ has made his presence felt. That's a traveling violation. No basket. Red Autry not happy. NC State back up 66-50.
Judah Mintz checking out the game after getting hit in the face. No call. Gets the technical foul.
Unsportsmanlike.
But now checks back into the game with his team trailing by 16. A quick 6-0 run by the Wolfpack.
So for the moment, that has quieted the Orange faithful. O'Connell, a pass to Middlebrooks. Tough catch. Lost it. Mintz goes down hard. A free basketball. Roycel off to Middlebrooks. And poked from behind. And out of bounds. NC State will have possession. Now they're going to head to the monitor. 8:25 to go.
Obi, you mentioned Syracuse still in contention for an NCAA at-large bid. This is a game that they need to try to keep those hopes alive. And we're seeing guys diving on the floor. But their energy and their effort has been met and exceeded by the Wolfpack in this game.
Coach Keats last night said, this is a team not just playing dangerous, as you referred to earlier, Corey, but desperate. He said, Joe Lunardi said, four ACC teams are getting in. That means 11 teams are in this predicament where they need the tournament to win. He said, this is a team that understands what they need to do together. And so trying to make sure that they're still in that conversation once this tournament is over, guys.
By the way, they had reset the shot clock. Weren't supposed to do that. And reset it to three after they did that. So that's why they went to the monitor.
Yeah, they didn't feel as though Syracuse ever gained possession, so no shot clock reset.
Inbound Middlebrooks, and will slam it down. Emphatically back to 18 here for NC State.
But that can't happen. 3 seconds remaining. The first thing you have to do is protect the basket. You give up a wide open dunk.
So the Wolfpack putting a stranglehold on this one. Mintz bodied up by Middlebrooks, who commits the foul on the baseline. His first personal.
And there's really nothing complicated. It's a simple, you just switch. Stay on the inside. Quadir Copeland either doesn't hear the switch call from Malik Brown or doesn't pay attention to it, but leaves Ben Middlebrooks wide open to catch and finish.
DJ Horn, who's had a great second half, with 14 points. Did not score in the first half. He's been a man here in the second half of the pack. Interior passing inside from Malik Brown. But of course, Syracuse cannot afford to be trading baskets here with the Wolfpack with 7:44 to go. NC State leading at 68-52 and going to take a little time off the clock. O'Connell. Middlebrooks up to set a screen. Roycel. Here's Taylor. Short.
Another offensive rebound for the Pack.
Taylor kept that one alive. O'Connell bouncing from Middlebrooks. Here's Taylor open. He missed a couple on that possession. Just over 7 minutes to go. Judah Mintz No. And Morcell with a rebound. NC State, the number 10 seed, looking to knock off the number 7 here tonight and move into the quarterfinal round. The Duke Blue Devils, the number 2 seed, awaiting the winner at 7 tomorrow in the quarterfinals. Shot clock a factor now, down to 3. Middlebrooks lost the handle on it. Coming up tonight after this game, Boston College and Clemson, number 11 and number 6. Here's Morcell on the other end to slam it.
How often have we seen that from the Wolfpack throughout this game? Kevin Keats' squad, 16-5 when they win the turnover battle. 2-9 when they tie or lose that battle. That was the 16th turnover for Syracuse to only 6 for the Wolfpack.
And turned over here, 5:59 to go. Well, this was actually a close game 6 or 7 minutes ago. It is no longer. The Wolfpack is rolling in Washington.
The first game has been a battle, fun to cover, but how about this second evening game? We got top 10 scoring big men. Quinton Post coming off a 30-13 game. P.J. Hall, third in the ACC in scoring. First team all ACC as well. It's going to be a battle of the bigs. I cannot wait to see our second game tonight and what that is going to look like in the paint, guys.
Angel, when you talk with the Boston College faithful, they told you that the game is going to have to be what?
Angel speechless. Under 6 minutes to go here. Post, by the way, pretty much personally ended the season of the Miami Hurricanes with that performance. Copeland. Looked like he got bottled up and he made the shot anyway.
I'm not sure Angel heard me. Angel, you talk with the Boston College faithful. They told you the next game has to be what for them to be successful?
Oh, it's got to be gritty, not pretty.
There you
go. These are some guys that are understanding they need to lay everything on the floor. And it's been fun to watch them, especially in that first game yesterday.
Warren will draw the foul and he'll be off to the line with about 5.5 remaining here. Syracuse actually led with 18:30 to go in the game, 39-37.
They came out with a 7-2 run to start the second half. Adrian Autry switched to the zone defensively, got 2 quick turnovers against NC State. We got off to a 7-2 run. Since then, 33-15 in favor of the Wolfpack, and they've used their defense and turnovers to be able to make that happen.
And this guy, DJ Horn, with an outstanding second half. With 15 points and another foul shot coming. He didn't play against Louisville with that hip flexor. But he warmed up today and then gave a thumbs up to the training staff. He did have to leave for a bit, for a chunk of time in the first half, but he returned and returned with a vengeance in the second.
He absolutely did. Picked up those 2 fouls early in the first half. Checked out.
Bell will launch and hit it. Such a good shooter.
He really is. And we mentioned 8 of 10 the last time these two teams played, but unable to stay on the floor in the first half. He would have been a difference maker not getting those 2 fouls.
It'll stay on this end for NC State, leading it 72-57. Middlebrooks to put it in. Warren Airborne went for the bank shot. The tip won't go. Diarra's shot won't go either. Finally knocked out by Syracuse.
But at this point, OB, the Wolfpack are playing volleyball. They just get it up on the rim, and between Ben Middlebrooks and Muhammad Diarra, these guys are going after every offensive rebound. They've been so good that we haven't even noticed the fact that DJ Burns has been sitting down for about the last 10 minutes because Middlebrooks and Diarra have dominated the offensive glass.
Just back in. And quickly a pass. Horn can't finish it. And his passing skills just off the charts. When you watch him bounce feed somebody as Syracuse gets sloppy here and just throws it away. DJ Burns with such great vision. And of course he can go over the top at 6'9",
but he's got a tremendous touch on those bounces.
But Obi, he's told me, I enjoy the double team. I invite the double team because it allows me to be able to show my passing acumen. It's easy to pass when there's one guy guarding. And that's normally when he goes to work, when it's got man-to-man coverage. But he loves the double team to be able to get his teammates involved.
They break the pressure. Horn comes out of there with it. He flips it here for Taylor. 4:40 left.
Judah Mintz right now having to defend DJ Burns.
This is one of those bounce passes. Marcel, and he'll draw the foul. As Malik Brown was a little late getting there. 72-57. ACC tournament round number two. The quarterfinals coming up tomorrow. As you say, the big boys taking the floor. And if you want to knock off one of those big boys, well, you get your chance tomorrow. North Carolina, Pitt, Duke, and Virginia. Those are your top four seeds. And they are in action tomorrow as Marcel makes the first one. North Carolina will take on FSU at noon. Pitt and Wake Forest at 2:30. Duke and the winner of this one at 7. And Virginia taking on the winner of Boston College and Clemson at 9:30.
Look at those numbers, OB. 8 points, 14 rebounds. And of those 14 rebounds, 7 of them on the offensive glass. The most by NC State player in the ACC tournament since 2012, the great C.J. Leslie doing the work on the glass back then.
Marcel making it 74-57. Former Virginia Cavalier. And another throwaway by Syracuse, which they have done over and over here in round two. It's been the most costly part of this game for Red Autry.
It really has been. Syracuse has shot themselves in the foot when you consider the opportunities that they've had and squandered away with the turnovers. Now 17 turnovers. Oh.
And 28 points off the turnovers. A collision right there at midcourt with 4:21 on the clock. As O'Connell went down. Now, DJ Burns, he shows a lot of personality, a lot of emotion.
He absolutely has, but always flashing that big smile and being a great teammate because he wants his teammates to shoot the basketball when he throws it to him. Back in the day, I used to tell guys, OB, look, I do the dribbling. I do the passing. When I throw it to you, you shoot it. That's what DJ Burns is telling
his
teammates.
It's your
right
turn
now.
Exactly,
because if I want somebody to dribble a pass, I'll do that. I don't need you to do that.
Yeah. He wanted DR to dunk it.
Yes, he did.
On that last possession we showed in his reaction. O'Connell at the line, 84% foul shooter. Michael O'Connell, who has an economics degree from Stanford.
I think he might be able to get a pretty good job with that.
Pretty much anywhere he wants to go.
Yeah.
He's going to run into some of you Virginia guys
along
the way.
Not bad to have that on the resume.
Mintz off for Copeland. His turnaround, that'll go. But 4 minutes to go and a big gap here. More pressure from the Orange.
We've seen crazier things happen. Now it's going to be up to the Wolfpack to handle the basketball and be able to make their free throws, which they did so well last night. But good things happen when you get the ball in the hands of the big fella. DJ Burns with a soft touch around the rim.
13 points for him.
But his impact has been so much bigger than 13 points. He's dominated this game really without having to score a big number.
Sure has. Breaking the press again.
Uh-oh, you ain't gonna dunk it, DJ.
Burns, no he's not. He's gonna very gently off the window. 80-59. NC State, they were actually trailing in the second half. But they have put this game on ice, it certainly feels like, with a tremendous run. Copeland from the corner, too strong. And a 33-13 romp that they went on, and a whistle. And they were using all of their weapons as part of their attack. And NC State loving it tonight here in Washington, D.C. All part of Champ Week. Champ week and a look at the Phillips 66 Big 12 Men's Championship bracket. Houston, of course, the overall number one in the country. Odd to see Kansas at number six, huh?
Absolutely. And one of the things I got to give the Big 12 credit for, can you remember, you know, 5-6 years ago where Kansas won the Big 12 every year?
Sure.
Think about what they've done. They followed the ACC. They've got different styles of play now. One of the reasons why Kansas has done so well in the NCAA tournament as late, because it used to be just Kansas and everyone else.
Mm-hmm.
Now when you look at the Big 12, you've got the Kelvin Sampson style of play, which is a rougher, more defensive side. You've got different styles of play, and I think that has prepared the Big 12 very well for the NCAA tournament, which has allowed them to catch up to the ACC.
O'Connell at the line, making one of two. And an 81-59 NC State advantage. They have played a tremendous second half, the Wolfpack. O'Connell will draw the foul coming out of there. Let's check in with Angel.
Well, Muhammad Diarra just got done with an extensive stretching session with some of the trainers. And just a reminder, he is recognizing Ramadan. So he is not eating from sun up to sundown. He was actually giving smoothies and food and fluids at the beginning of this game. So, I mean, he may be needing a little salt, maybe smoothie. I don't know. But at the end of the day, it's good to see him smiling and also the team taking care of business.
32 minutes and 14 rebounds. Man, did he play hard.
I can tell you right now, I do a lot of stretching, but I don't smile. It doesn't feel as good as it does when
he actually looked like he was enjoying it.
Oh, he was, absolutely. But he's enjoying the fact that he's been dominant in this game. We talk about DJ Burns' impact on this game. DR just as dominant. 14 rebounds, 7 of those on the offensive glass. And when you look at the numbers throughout this game, a 20-7 advantage for the Wolfpack in second chance points. Muhammad Diarra had a whole lot to do with that.
I'll tell you another guy who needs to get some love is Jaden Taylor. 18 points in this game. 6 out of 12, 3 out of 7 from the three-point land. Syracuse getting on the board, 83-61. NC State with a commanding lead inside 3 minutes to play. It'll be Mintz at the line.
The Wolfpack had 5 players in double figures in their win yesterday. Only 4. However, DR's 14 rebounds and 8 points classify him for, you know, we're going to call that a double-double. Whenever you got 7 offensive rebounds, we'll give you the double-double for that, regardless of the fact that you're 2 points short.
Now, you have talked about DJ Burns, though, and playing only 11 minutes against Louisville. They won that game. But a different story tonight. He was on the floor for, you know, 24, 25 minutes.
And well, the difference is, against Louisville yesterday, Brandon Hudley Hatfield attacked DJ Burns. He had to defend. In this game, there was no one attacking DJ Burns. So he was able to conserve all of his energy. He did not get in foul trouble and was able to conserve his energy for what he does on the offensive end of the floor. And he's been dynamic here this evening.
Mintz gets bottled up there on the baseline, throws it away to O'Connell. Middlebrooks running the floor. Crowd thought he walked with that. Out in front, it's Mintz, and Mintz with the finish. Syracuse will take a timeout, but a 20-point game with 2 minutes to go. 83-63, the Wolfpack opening it up in a huge way here in the second half.
Whenever you talk about the DMV, and especially you're talking D.C., you got to mention Archbishop Carroll High School, the George Lefkowitz Gym, of course, the legend that is George Lefkowitz. However, in the hallway, there is the standing of the man. That's right, that's Big John, John Thompson, in the hallway, just monitoring the students as they walk through.
That would keep me in line.
Yeah, me too. Alma mater, of course, Troy Weaver, the general manager of the Detroit Pistons, and Lawrence Moten, Slow Mo. As you see, JT3, who is not a Carroll alum, but all a Gonzaga alum right down the street where Judah Mintz actually went to high school. But, of course, John Thompson III recognizing the statue of his father that sits in the hallway of Archbishop Carroll High School.
Well, his dad, one of the greatest coaches of all time, and up against Jim Boeheim in the glory years of the Big East. some of the greatest matchups anyone ever saw in college basketball with Hall of Famers everywhere you look.
Absolutely. I wore my Hoya J's in here yesterday while I was working with Jim Boeheim just to remind him of the rivalry that happens in this building.
That was very sweet of you to do that.
Well, you know, I wanted to make sure I brought it up.
Just over 2 minutes to go. ESPN's exclusive presentation of college basketball is presented by T. Rowe Price. All part of Champ Week. Invest with confidence. By the way, yesterday was the anniversary of the six overtime game, right?
Yesterday was a lot of anniversaries, but it was absolutely the anniversary of the six overtime game. Syracuse prevailing and kept everyone up. I believe the game was 3 hours and 47 minutes. Syracuse keeping everyone up late night because nobody, of course, once you start watching the third, fourth, fifth overtime, it's not like you can walk away from the game.
Nobody left. No.
My little bro.
Our stats man, Dave Corris, was there with Sean McDonough, Jay Billis, Bill Raftery. Pass in the game, tried to get the shot up, blocked back at him, and that's a shot clock violation.
My little bro, Eric Diebendorf, of course, starring in that game, now working with us at ACC Network. But let me ask you this. When you mentioned Billis, Rath, and McDonough, which one of those three you think asked for double pay for the fact that they had to do an additional 30 minutes?
No question, it was McDonough.
Okay, I was just checking. That would have been my guess.
Asked, and I think got it, actually. Mintz in the paint, floats it up there for two. It just has not been enough of that to keep pace with NC State in the second half. He is 21. 83-65 with about a minute to go. So the Wolfpack will cruise into the second round. This was a tight game for a long time. But NC State, they've got a lot of weapons.
They really do. And when they've got their four perimeter players playing as well as they have, when you consider O'Connell, Casey Morsell, Horn, and Taylor, and then you're getting the production on the interior that they got. I mean, this was a complete game. Everyone that had on the red uniform was productive throughout this game.
Now, the last time Duke and NC State met, that was in Raleigh. Duke came away with the victory. Although Burns had a great game individually, he had 27 points for the Wolfpack. But Duke came away with an impressive win on the road in that contest.
But I'm sure as you look at the DJs, DJ Burns, DJ Horn, on the bench, they're looking forward to another opportunity against the Blue Devils here in the ACC tournament.
On the line, out of bounds, 23.5 to go. And still to come for us on ESPNU, it'll be Boston College and Clemson. NC State to celebrate an impressive win. Great second half by the Wolfpack. They ran away with this one. Syracuse led 39-37 with 18 and a half minutes to go. And then it was a 21-4 run by NC State to ice this victory. And the Wolfpack wins again. I don't know, is it going to be a magic carpet ride for the Wolfpack here in Washington?
It's happened before. Can it happen again? This team can be extremely dangerous, getting production from so many guys up and down the lineup. And the first time they've won multiple games in the ACC tournament in 10 years, is this a magical pack?
Duke is next, the number two seed at 7 o'clock. That will be tomorrow on ESPN. So can't wait for that one. NC State rolling after halftime and doing it with a lot of emotion, too.
Played so well. He kept a smile on his face throughout the majority of this game and wanting to keep his career going. It's at the end of the line for DJ Burns, for Casey Marcel, for DJ Horn. They don't want this ride to be over yet, and they walk away with an 18-point victory over the Orange.
So they are on to the quarterfinals. NC State, the number 10 seed, about to take on the number 2 seed. NC State picking up their 19th victory of the season. And let's go to Angel with DJ Horn.
How you doing? How you doing?
DJ was ready to walk off the court, but I think after halftime we saw that hip flexor felt a little good, especially after that dunk. 14 points for you in the second half. Just describe how you're feeling to this point.
I'm feeling good, man. You know, to get hurt with the last couple of games of my season remaining, you know, it was definitely tough on me mentally, but my teammates, my coaches, the staff, you know, did a great job with me getting treatment and just, you know, making sure my head stayed in it, and I'm glad that we was able to come out here and get this win.
Speaking of this win, this is not a team that entered this tournament with a lot of momentum. Describe over these last two games what you've seen.
Yeah, man, we've just been as locked in as we can be. I feel like we've been locked in as we've been all season. And we're going into this tournament, we just kind of went in with a why not us mindset. And I think we're, you know, showcasing that right now.
Mohamed Diarra with 14 rebounds. How big was he for you guys tonight?
He was big, man. When Mo wants to be like Mo, he's the X factor for this team. And I'm glad that he showed up on the biggest stage when it all matters.
Thanks. Congrats on the win. We'll see you tomorrow.
Thank you.
DJ looking pretty healthy in that second half, 16. DJ Burns with 15 and also 6 rebounds. Jaden Taylor with 18 and Michael O'Connor with 16. So it is on to the next round, the quarterfinal round. NC State knocking off Syracuse here in Washington. Hope you'll join us for the second night game coming up shortly. Right now, let's get it back to the studio and Dallin and Tom.
Right now, let's take a look at some of the other actions from around the second round today. And that would be Syracuse, NC State. Syracuse, the 7 seed. NC State, the 10 seed. We pick it up at the half with the Wolfpack up 3 at the break. Close game so far, and DJ Burns starts going to work inside. Luke?
Yeah, I mean, he gets to the left hand. It is an absolute bucket. I mean, I think you take his right hand off his body, he's the same exact player. But, man, when he gets in the paint, he's got the footwork, he's got the touch, does a little bit of everything for this team.
Then drills the three on the outside. It's Jaden Taylor who eventually ends up
with
it.
Does he get an assist for that, DJ Burns? I'm not sure. That's not a pass. That's a tap out.
Bench loving what they see. And then Burns to Taylor again, Booth.
Taylor was on fire. Burns started it off, and Taylor kept it going.
Next possession, trouble for Syracuse, Joel, is Judamitz gets stripped.
Yeah, and that was the name of the game right there. NC State had 30 points off of turnovers. And the thing is, it was the live ball turnovers. And that way you can't get back on defense. And here again, another steal from DJ Horn.
He looks healthy, doesn't he?
Yeah, that hip flexor isn't bothering him.
Especially in the second half, he really got hot. NC State wins it 83-65 to advance to the next round. You take a look at those second half stats and something the guys were just hitting on. NC State outscored the Orange by 15 in the second half. 23 points off of 12 turnovers, 12-0 in second chance points, 18 bench points, and 16 of those came from DJ Horn, who got all 16 of his points in the second half. DJ joined Booz and I after the game, and we asked about how he was feeling because he had some issues with that hip yesterday and in the first half today.
It's definitely been frustrating, but I just got to give credit to our training staff, my coaches and teammates. They've just been, you know, trying to keep me as locked in as possible. And just going into all of this, you know, I've been trying to be a good teammate for my teammates. Because I know, you know, being who I am kind of can, you know, give off some energy to them. So that's what I've just been trying to do these past couple days.
You must have had a good talk at halftime, too, because as I mentioned, you come out and you have 16. The points that you guys scored off of turnovers, the second chance points in the second half. I mean, you just guys absolutely dominated. What was the conversation like in the locker room about what you needed to do to secure this win?
We just knew coming into this game we were going to have to up the pressure on them. We knew the first two times we played them, we felt like we didn't really pressure their guards enough, and they were able to kind of just get whatever they wanted. So coming into this game, it was definitely an emphasis on, you know, disrupting some of that.
Talk to me about the next challenge. You got Duke tomorrow. Talk to me about some of the matchup problems that they proposed to you guys and what you guys can do to get a victory tomorrow night.
They definitely have a great backcourt. So we're going to start there. So we're going to definitely have to, you know, get some rest, quick turnaround for tomorrow. And then as far as, you know, down low, they got Kyle Filipowski, and he's, you know, within himself, you know, a great player. So we just got to go back, get ready, watch film, and just prepare for this next game, game at a time.
Glad to see you guys play just a little while ago at the beginning of the month, and looking forward to seeing what happens this go around. 3 games in 3 days. I know that's always a quick turnaround, and you got to stay healthy. We'll let you get out of here. We
go get some treatment.
Time.
Go get some treatment.
But not too much treatment. If you play Duke is what you want. No, we want you healthy. Yeah, we appreciate it, DJ.
Thank you, guys.
I would say, Luke, he looks like he's feeling pretty good based off of what we saw in the second half.
Yeah, he must have been stretching out in that first half, just trying to get himself loose and limber, because in the second half, the confidence was rolling. He knocked down everything. They made huge plays, and it was such a team effort. I mean, you look at even a guy like Mo Diarra. Mm-hmm. He has 8 points, 14 rebounds, 6 assists. Just a team effort. I know DJ Horn was electric in that second half, but this was one of the best performances by NC State, and their pressure and their physicality. I know Coach is a little unhappy that they didn't get a couple more calls for Judah Mintz, but you have to adjust to some of these referees and the tournament atmosphere, and NC State, they did that, and they were ultra physical, and when they weren't calling fouls, they just kept coming at them.
They give all the credit to NC State. They didn't call them. You just keep doing it. Yeah. Syracuse, you know, if they shoot 6 free throws, they're not beating anybody in the country.
Right.
Their game is driving and getting fouled, getting to the foul line. And, you know, Judah Mintz averages 8.8 or something free throws a game, and the team got 6.
Right.
So they're not winning that kind of game. But you have to give credit to NC State. They played, I thought last night set it up, without Horn playing,
mm-hmm.
the other guys really played.
Confidence.
Mm-hmm. And they came back today with that confidence. I think they're a way better team right now than at any time this year. And I've always said, and we said a little bit earlier in the show, you get those games under your belt in this tournament and somebody's sitting there waiting to play, there's a big advantage. It doesn't always work that way that you're right. But it's an advantage.
Joel, we touched on DJ Horn, but how about what we've seen from Michael O'Connell yesterday and today? During the regular season, he's averaging 4 points. He had 16 today and had a great night last night, too.
On 6 shots today, by the way.
Yeah, very efficient. And that's what you need from the surrounding players. You need guys that can come in. And, you know, we're not asking them to be superstars. They just have to come in and play their role. Michael O'Connell, 16 today, 16 yesterday. And then we also throw in there Jaylen Taylor.
Yes.
Jaylen Taylor had 18 points yesterday.
Big steal
had
yesterday.
18 points today. So
9 rebounds. Yep.
When you talk about DJ Horn being out yesterday, even DJ Burns not playing yesterday, now these other guys, as Coach Boeheim said, come in and they gain that confidence. And this is what you need in these type of tournaments.
They're in the quarterfinals back-to-back years for the first time since 2014, 2015 now. And we'll get a little in-state rivalry tomorrow with Duke. We'll also get to see an in-state rivalry game between Duke and NC State. Booze, and mention what has happened in the previous meetings with those two teams. What does NC State need to do if they want to upset this hot Blue Devils team?
They got to take care of the ball as well, play inside. You saw what DJ Burns was able to do at NC State the last time they played. I say go through the big fella, obviously. I think it's going to be a tall task. I think Filipowski's not going to have a 9-point game like he did in that game. The Duke guards are really outstanding. Obviously, the guards didn't say got to come and bring it because they're so dynamic and they're so different. McCain's knocking down threes and transition from all over. Proctor's, you know, gauging, making plays and also shooting threes. And then Jeremy Roach is so shifty, able to go from here, go from there, shoot the three, get to the bucket. So NC State will have their hands full. But if I'm them, I play inside out with DJ Burns.
DJ Horn's got to keep rolling. At 16 in that second half, if this is a situation where a team comes out here and gets in a rhythm, it's going to be DJ Horn knocking down shots on the perimeter. And I agree with you. DJ Burns is just such a mismatch. He's so big. He's got such great footwork. And when he gets you leaning, he's got you right where he wants you because he can spin off so well, gets to that left hand, and it's over.
When we talked to DJ Horn, you could tell how grateful he was that he was healthy enough to play. He was saying how hard it was to not be able to go yesterday and struggled some in the first half. So know that he is going to be fired up as well, this Wolfpack team, especially after the way they finished that second half off against Syracuse. So that'll be the 7 o'clock game tomorrow, NC State and Duke. We've also got Pitt and Wake Forest. We hit on that. That'll be at 2:30. The night game will be between Virginia and Boston College, BC. 2 games in 2 days so far, getting ready for another third game tomorrow.